Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Touching Evil by Kay Hooper. Some cops think police sketch artist Maggie Barnes is telepathic, that she can actually enter the victims' minds. Only Maggie knows the truth behind her rare talent, and she isn't telling. And now, Touching Evil.
Prologue. It was cold. She could feel the wind tugging at her hair, hear it whining around the eaves and rattling what sounded like a loose piece of tin somewhere. The cold, moisture-laden air left her skin clammy and chilled her all the way to her bones. She supposed she was in shock. It was an odd sensation. Shock. A curious sort of limbo where nothing disturbed her very much. So it must have been instinct rather than concern that prompted her to move, to pull herself forward, despite the pain. The unevenness of the floor was both a help and a torture, providing fingerholds even as it cruelly scraped her skin and gouged her body. She felt one of her fingernails tear painfully and was conscious of dirt and crusted blood underneath the few that were left undamaged. And probably corrupting evidence or something. Probably really screwing things up. But that didn't seem important either. She focused on what was. Just keep reaching out. One hand at a time. Hold on to something, no matter how much it hurts. Pull yourself forward, no matter how much it hurts. It became automatic. Mechanical. Reach, grab, pull. Reach, grab, pull. There went another fingernail. Damn. Reach, grab, pull. When her reaching fingers abruptly encountered thin air, it took her several minutes of fumbling exploration to realize she was at the top of the stairs. Stairs. Just the thought of her aching body bumping down rough step after rough step made her shudder, and she heard a thin sound of dread, hardly louder than a whimper, escape her swollen lips. It was going to hurt like hell. It did. Somewhere near the bottom, her strength gave out, and she slid over the last few steps in an agonizing rush that left her sprawled, limp and sobbing quietly on the ancient tile floor that smelled of dirt and cooked cabbage and urine. She might have slept a while, or maybe just lay unconscious, because her body refused to go on. But eventually the same instinct that had driven her this far insisted she begin moving again. I have to. I have to. Yes, you have to. That was peculiar. That other alien voice in her head. She thought about it for a while, curling into a fetal position on her side, even though the position was more painful. It was getting harder and harder to breathe. Broken rib, probably. Three broken ribs, and a punctured lung. Listen to me, Hollis. You have to keep moving. Someone will be passing by in just a few minutes. If you aren't outside by then, you won't be found until tomorrow. How strange. The voice knew her name. Tomorrow will be too late, Hollis. Yes, she thought it probably would be too late. Do you want to live? Did she? She thought she did. Not that it would be the life she had once before. In fact, it might not be much of a life at all, but, damn it, she wanted it. If only to live long enough for... vengeance? Justice. Hollis turned painfully back onto her belly and began the methodical effort of inching forward once again. She thought she was making progress, at least until she encountered a wall. Damn. Listening, she thought she could hear faint traffic sounds. That was her only clue to the whereabouts of a door that would allow her to escape the building. She began to feel her way along the wall toward the sounds. It was getting colder. The wind that had whistled through the building during her entire agonizing journey downstairs was blowing in her face now. She guessed the building had long ago lost most of its windows and doors, so the wind found easy passage, stirring the dust and mold of many long years of neglect, even as it cut into her shivering body. Just a little farther now, Hollis. She wondered why the voice didn't just call 911, but thought that was probably too much to ask of a figment of her imagination. There's the doorway. Feel it? She felt the threshold under her sore fingers, ancient weather stripping or something that was mostly rust. Beyond it was the broken concrete of a stoop or walkway. Hollis prayed there weren't any more steps. Grimly, she pulled herself across the threshold and out of the building, shivering as the full force of the cold wind out there cut into her. There was one painful step down, then a walkway that seemed to be more rocks and gravel than concrete. It hurt like hell to pull herself across that jagged surface. The only saving grace was that it continued to guide her toward the street. She hoped. "Not long now, Hollis. You're almost there." "Almost where?" she wondered. "Out in the street, so a car could run over her?" "He's near. He'll see you any minute now." Before Hollis could wonder who was supposed to see her, she heard a male voice utter a shocked exclamation, then hurried footsteps coming toward her. "Please," Hollis heard herself say in an unfamiliar, thickened voice. "Please help." "It's all right." The man's voice, near now, sounded nearly as thickened as her own had been, and shocked and horrified and compassionate. He touched her shoulder gently with a warm hand, then said, "I don't want to move you until EMS gets here, but I'm going to cover you with my coat, okay?" She felt the blessed warmth and murmured a thanks, allowing her weary head to fall so that it rested on her forearm. She was very tired. Very tired. "Sleep now, Hollis." She thought that was a good idea. Sam Lewis checked her pulse just to make sure, then took a couple of steps away from her and spoke urgently into a cell phone. "For God's sake, hurry! She's in bad shape. She's lost a lot of blood." His gaze followed the startlingly bright, smeared trail of blood that marked her progress across broken concrete all the way back to the gaping doorway of the long-abandoned old house. He tried to listen to the professionally detached voice in his ear, but finally he cut off the 911 operator's questions by saying sharply, "I don't know what happened to her, but she's bruised and cut up and bleeding and naked. Maybe she was raped, I don't know, but something else happened to her. She's... her eyes are gone. No, damn it, not injured. Gone. Somebody's cut her eyes out." Chapter 1. Thursday, November 1st, 2001. "She's not going to like this." Andy Brenner's voice was more unhappy than worried. John Garrett stepped past him into the small, bare room. "I'll take the flak," he said, his gaze already fixed on the large two-way mirror that dominated the far wall and offered them a secret view into another small room. This mostly bare room contained a scarred wooden table and several chairs. Three women sat at the table, the two facing the mirror sitting close together in a posture that suggested they were clinging to each other, even though they weren't touching. The younger of the two wore very dark, heavy-rimmed sunglasses and sat rigidly in her chair, while the older woman watched her worriedly. Sitting at right angles to them at the table, her back to the mirror, was the third woman, her face hidden from the watching men. It was impossible to guess her shape, since she wore a bulky flannel shirt and faded jeans, but a rather wild cloud of long, dark red hair made her appear slight. Andy sighed. "It's not Flack I'm worried about. The chief likes to pretend Maggie works for us on our terms, but the rank and file know better. What Maggie wants, Maggie gets, and she wants total privacy when she's interviewing a victim. She'll never know we're here." "I keep trying to tell you, John. She'll know." "How?" "I push this button, and we can hear what's going on in the room, but they won't hear us, right? We see in, they don't see out. So how will she know we're here?
Beats the hell out of me.
But she will.
Andy watched the other man move closer to the window and stifled another sigh. Anybody else, and he would have stuck to his guns. But John Garrett was a hard man to say no to.
Andy tried to think of an argument he hadn't used yet, but before he could come up with anything, John pushed the right button, and a quiet, curiously pleasing voice reached them clearly and without any of the tinny, hollow characteristics that were usual with an intercom.
How difficult this is for you, Ellen. If I could, I'd far rather wait and give you more time to... heal?
The woman wearing the sunglasses laughed, a brittle sound, holding no amusement.
My husband is sleeping in the guest room, Miss Barnes. My little boy is afraid of me. I can't find my way through my own house without knocking over furniture and bumping into walls, and my sister has to cook for my family and help me dress every morning.
Ellen, you know I'm happy to help,
her sister protested, her soft voice half pleading and half weary.
And Owen wouldn't be sleeping in the guest room if it wasn't what you wanted. You know that.
I know he can't bear to touch me, Lindsay.
Ellen's voice was tight, a bare note away from shrill. Her hands were clasped together on the table, and her long, pale fingers writhed.
And I don't blame him for that. I can't blame him. Why would he want to touch me after...
Maggie Barnes reached across the table and covered Ellen's hands with one of her own.
Listen to me, Ellen.
Her voice remained quiet, but there was a new note in it now, an oddly soothing, almost hypnotic rhythm.
What that animal did to you can never be undone, but you can't allow it to destroy you. Do you hear me? Don't give him that power over you. Don't allow him to win.
Listening, John unconsciously tilted his head to one side, trying to focus on the strangely compelling undercurrent he heard in her voice. It was as if he knew that sound, as if it was something he only half remembered, like a song from his childhood or the last faint notes of music from a dream chased away by morning. Haunting. Ellen didn't attempt to free her hands, and her rigid posture seemed to ease a bit. Just a bit.
I don't want to remember,
she said, low, almost whispering.
Don't ask me to remember.
I have to.
The regret in Maggie's voice was achingly genuine.
I need your memories. Need every scrap of information you can give me. I need you to remember everything you can, Ellen. Every sound, every scent, every touch.
Ellen's shudder was visible.
He touched. I can't bear to think how he touched me. Please don't make me.
Don't make her.
Lindsay's face twisted, and she put a hesitant hand on her sister's arm.
I don't have a choice,
Maggie said.
The police can't catch this animal without some idea who he is, what he looks like. We can't even warn other women to watch out for him. Ellen, some detail you remember may help me put a face on him.
She turned her head suddenly. John actually started in surprise at the abruptness of the movement, and the fact that he had the unsettling feeling she was looking directly into his eyes, even through the two-way mirror. She had very light brown eyes, the only unusual feature in a face that was pleasant but unremarkable. And those pale eyes were looking right at him. He was sure of it. He felt it. Behind him, Andy murmured,
"Told you."
Hardly conscious of speaking aloud, John said,
"She sees me.
How can she..."
X-ray vision.
How the hell do I know? Andy sounded as disgruntled as he felt. He hated it when Maggie was mad at him, and she was definitely going to be mad at him. Maggie turned back to face the other two women and spoke gently.
I'm sorry, but there's something I have to do. I'll be right back.
Lindsay gave her an accusing look, then leaned closer to her sister as though in support. Ellen didn't say a word, but she had the appearance of someone poised on the brink, frozen, as if unable to move forward or back. John turned his back to the mirror as Maggie left the interview room.
She must have heard us, he said.
No, Andy said. She didn't hear us. This room is soundproofed. I told you that. She just knew. That's all. The door of the observation room opened, and Maggie Barnes stepped inside. John was surprised at how tall she was. At least 5'10", if he was any judge. But he hadn't been mistaken in thinking her slight. She wasn't unnaturally thin, just one of those very slender, almost ethereal women. He wondered if she dressed in the bulky layers out of some need to have more weight or substance. When he looked at her face, John decided he'd been wrong in thinking it unremarkable. Graced with very regular features, not quite pretty, but pleasant, it was saved from plainness by those slanted, cat-like golden eyes, and something stamped into her expression, innate to it, that was more than compassion and less than pity. A kind of empathy for the feelings of others that he knew was far more rare and valuable than high cheekbones or a perfect nose. She looked at him briefly, a head-to-toe glance that missed nothing along the way, and left him with the disconcerted realization that he had been very accurately weighed and analyzed. Andy did his best to melt into the woodwork before she looked at him, but obviously felt pinned to it instead, when those cat-like eyes fixed on him. He held his hands out, palms up, and offered an apologetic shrug. Andy? Her voice was very gentle.
Sorry, Maggie.
He shifted uncomfortably, ruefully aware that he probably looked for all the world like a scolded schoolboy. John stepped toward them.
It's my fault, Miss Barnes. I asked Andy to bend the rules. My name is...
I know who you are, Mr. Garrett.
Her gaze was direct, her voice matter-of-fact. But some rules apply to you, too, whether you like it or not.
It wasn't a question of rules not applying to me. I have special permission to observe the investigation. He only just managed not to sound defensive, which surprised him.
And that includes watching and listening like a voyeur while a shattered woman forces herself to remember a nightmare you can't even begin to imagine. Is that the observing you were given permission to do?
John stiffened. But her accusation struck a nerve and left him at least momentarily silent.
Maggie didn't wait for a response, but went on coolly.
How would you feel, Mr. Garrett, if two strange men had watched and listened in silence and secret while someone you cared about relived the entire horrific experience of being brutally raped and maimed by an animal?
That struck more than a nerve.
He drew a breath and let it out slowly.
You're right. I'm sorry.
Andy said,
Sounded like you were reaching her there for a minute. The interruption won't help things, will it?
No. No, it won't help things. I'll try again, but she may not be willing to talk to me any more today.
John felt the reproach, even though she wasn't looking at him.
I'm sorry, he said again. I didn't intend to interfere. That's the last thing I wanted to do.
Fine. Then you won't mind leaving.
She stepped back, holding the door open in a clear invitation, if not a command, for them to leave. Andy wasted no time in obeying, but John paused in the doorway and met her gaze steadily.
I would like to talk to you, Miss Barnes. Today, if possible.
If you want to wait around, suit yourself.
Her tone was indifferent, but the steady golden eyes never left his.
I may be a while.
I'll wait, John said. Hollis was awake, but didn't move or make a sound to indicate that. For the first few moments, it was always like this. Tension and terror until her scrambling mind left nightmare and caught up with reality. Which was also a nightmare. The bandages over her eyes, over where her eyes had once been, were becoming a familiar weight. She didn't yet know how she felt about the fact that beneath those bandages were now someone else's eyes. An accident victim who had lost her life but left a signed donor card behind. The surgeon, proud of his groundbreaking work, had been surprised and rather aggrieved when Hollis's only question had been one he obviously considered unimportant.
"What color are they?"
"Miss Templeton, I don't think you understand the complexity."
"I understand, Doctor. I understand that you believe medical science has advanced to the point that I'll be able to see with this poor woman's eyes. And I understand that it'll be days at least, possibly weeks, before we find out if you're right. In the meantime, I'm asking what color my new eyes are."
"Blue," he'd said. Her old ones had been brown. Would she be able to see? She didn't know. And she suspected that her doctor, for all his confidence in his abilities, was unsure of the surgery's outcome as well. The optic nerve was a tricky thing. He didn't have to tell her that. And then there were all the other nerves, the blood vessels, the muscles. Far too many tiny connections to be certain of anything. They didn't think her body would reject the new eyes, and anti-rejection drugs would probably make certain of that. But nobody seemed nearly as sure what her brain might do. Vision was as much the mind's interpretation of images as it was anything else, after all. With the intricate connection between organ and mind severed and then painstakingly rebuilt, who really knew what her brain's response might be? Hell, maybe it was no wonder she hadn't even been able to decide how she felt about it. Most of the other physical injuries had been surprisingly minor, given everything she'd been through. The broken ribs were healing, though she still breathed carefully, and doctors had repaired the puncture in her lung. A few stitches here and there, scrapes and bruises. Oh, and she'd never be able to have children, but what the hell? No kid needed to be saddled with a probably blind, certainly emotionally wrecked mother anyway, right? Right.
"I know you're awake, Hollis."
She didn't move. Didn't turn her head. That voice again. Quietly insistent, as it had been virtually every day of the past 3 weeks. She'd asked a nurse once who it was that came to visit her and sit by her bed hour after hour. But the nurse had said she didn't know. Hadn't seen anyone except the police officers who came regularly to ask gentle questions Hollis didn't answer. Hollis had so far refused to question the voice, just as she refused to speak to the cops or say any more than absolutely necessary to the doctors and nurses. She wasn't ready to think about what had happened to her, far less talk about it. "You'll be able to leave soon," the voice said. "What will you do then?" "Stepping in front of a bus might be a good idea," Hollis said calmly. She spoke aloud to remind herself that hers was really the only voice in the room. Of course it was, because that other voice was just a figment of her imagination, obviously. "If you really wanted to die, you never would have crawled out of that building." "And if I wanted rational platitudes from a figment of my imagination, I'd go back to sleep." "Oh, wait. I am asleep. I'm dreaming. It's all just a bad dream." "You know better." "Better that it happened? Or better that you aren't just a figment of my imagination?" Instead of answering either question, the figment said, "If I handed you a lump of clay, what would you make, Hollis?" "What kind of question is that? One of those ink blot questions? Is my figment psychoanalyzing me? What would you make? You're an artist.
I was an artist.
Before, you created art with your hands and your eyes and your mind. Whether or not the surgery is successful, you still have your hands. You still have your mind. The figment, Hollis realized, didn't believe she'd be able to see with those borrowed eyes either. So I should just turn myself into a sculptor? It isn't quite as simple as that. I didn't say it was simple. I didn't say it would be easy. But it would be a life, Hollis. A rich, creative life. After a moment, Hollis said, I don't know if I can. I don't know if I'm brave enough to start over. You'll have to find out, then, won't you? Hollis smiled, despite herself. So her figment could offer more than knee-jerk platitudes, after all. And the challenge was unexpectedly bracing. I guess so. That or go looking for that bus to step in front of. Miss Templeton? Were you speaking to me? The day shift nurse was a bit hesitant as she approached the bed. Hollis was learning to read footsteps, even the nearly soundless ones of the nurses. This nurse feared for Hollis's sanity. It wasn't the first time she'd caught the patient talking to herself. Miss Templeton? No, Janet, I wasn't speaking to you. Just talking to myself again. Unless there's somebody sitting in that chair beside the bed, of course. Warily, Janet said, No, Miss Templeton, there's nobody in the chair. Ah, well then, I must have been talking to myself. But don't let it worry you. I did that even before the attack. She had learned to refer to it that way, as the attack. It was the phrase the doctors used, the nurses, the cops. Can I get you anything, Miss Templeton? No, Janet. No, thank you. I think I'll take a nap. I'll make sure nobody bothers you, Miss Templeton. Hollis listened to the footsteps recede and pretended to be asleep. It wasn't difficult. The hard part was keeping herself from asking aloud if the figment was still here. Because it couldn't be, of course. Unless she really was crazy. We're no further along than we were when you were here 6 weeks ago. Luke Drummond, the lieutenant in charge of detectives in this division of the Seattle PD, was accustomed to reporting to his superiors, but he disliked being obliged to divulge details of an ongoing investigation to a civilian, and his hostility showed, especially since he couldn't report any progress. There have been 2 more victims since then. John Garrett kept his voice level, and still no evidence, no clues to lead you any closer to identifying this bastard. He's very good at what he does, Drummond said. And you aren't? Drummond's eyes narrowed, and he leaned back in his chair, deceptively relaxed. I have a very skilled and experienced squad of detectives, Mr. Garrett. We also have some damn good forensics experts on the payroll and state-of-the-art equipment. But none of that is much good when there's no evidence to study or witnesses to question, and when the victims are, to say the least, traumatized and unable to give us much to go on. What about Maggie Barnes? What about her? She hasn't come up with anything useful? Well, as everybody keeps reminding me, what she does is an art, and apparently it can't be rushed. He shrugged. In all fairness to Maggie, she hasn't had much more to work with than the rest of us. The first 2 victims are, well, I don't have to tell you. But neither gave us anything much to go on right after the attacks. The third is just now well enough physically to sit down and talk to Maggie. And the fourth is not only still in the hospital, but so far hasn't been willing to answer even the simplest question from any of us. All the shrinks tell us that if we push these women, we'll lose any chance we might have of gaining any relevant information from either of them.
Why haven't you called the FBI?
John demanded.
Because there's nothing they can do that we can't,
Drummond replied tersely. John wasn't so sure about that, but he knew he was on the edge of alienating Drummond completely and dared not push any harder. Pulling the right strings had gotten John access to the investigation, but if Drummond wanted, he could make that access fairly useless. Holding his voice level, he said,
So the consensus is that Maggie Barnes is your best bet to getting something useful from the victims?
If anybody can guide those women back through the hell they experienced without hurting them even more, it's Maggie. Whether she gets anything we can use, it's something else. We'll just have to wait and see. He watched John Garrett shift in his chair almost unconsciously, and for the first time felt a genuine pang of sympathy for the other man. He might be a pain in the ass at the moment, but his motives were certainly understandable. And Drummond could hardly blame him for muscling in on the investigation. In Garrett's place, Drummond thought he'd probably do the same. Assuming, of course, that he had $1 billion or so and a shitload of political influence to make both the chief and the mayor practically piss their pants in their eagerness to be cooperative. Luke Drummond would have loved to have at least that political influence. He intended to sit in the governor's mansion one day. He hadn't made any secret of his political aspirations, and despite not being an elected official, tended to react to any situation as a politician rather than a cop. But to date, that hadn't hurt either his present career or his ambitions. He was enough of a cop to be able to do his job and do it well. At least until this damned psychopath had turned up. At the moment, however, Drummond had neither Garrett's political juice nor his money, so it was in the cop's best interest to be at least courteous to the man. Maggie needs time to interview the two surviving victims, he said evenly. We have to be patient. He attacked Hollis Templeton a little more than 3 weeks ago. How much longer do you think he'll wait before he acts again? John heard the edgy tension in his own voice, but he was beyond being able to hide it. Drummond sighed. According to the shrinks, he could grab another woman tomorrow, or 6 months from now. So far he hasn't established any kind of time pattern we can identify. There were 2 months between the first two victims, but he grabbed the third only 2 weeks later. Then he waited nearly 3 months to strike a fourth time. No pattern, John echoed. And nothing else to hang our hats on. No blood evidence other than the victims. And he was smart enough to wear condoms, so there's been no semen found. Nothing under the fingernails of the victims. No hair or fibers found on them or anywhere near them. Nothing to identify where he might have held them. They're always dumped someplace else afterward. A remote or at least unoccupied building. Ellen Randall remembers being transported inside something, the trunk of a car, she thinks. But since he stuck to pavement, we didn't find any tire tracks. How was Hollis Templeton transported? We don't know. Not yet. I told you, she's not answering our questions. Her doctors say Maggie can try talking to her in a few days. That's if she's agreeable. And she probably won't be, since she hasn't been anxious to talk to us so far. What then? I don't know. Drummond sighed again. Look, Garrett, I'm sorry as hell, but there's nothing more I can tell you, at least not at the moment. We're doing the best we can, and that's all. Andy was waiting for John around the corner from Drummond's office and offered a wry, Told you so. I can see I'm going to make myself real popular around here, John said. Oh, don't mind Drummond. He's a nice enough guy. For a politician. I'd rather he were just a cop. Yeah, so would most of us. But we comfort ourselves with the certainty that he won't be around long. Just long enough to get a secure toehold to boost himself higher up the food chain. In the meantime, however, we're stuck with him. Andy led the way to his own corner of the bullpen, snagging 2 cups of coffee as they passed the pot.
Geez, Andy, take it all, why don't you? A nearby younger cop grumbled. You could at least make another pot. I made the last one, Scott. Your turn. John sat in Andy's visitor's chair and accepted one of the cardboard cups. He took a sip, grimaced, and said,
This is really lousy coffee, Andy.
Usually is, no matter who makes it. Unoffended, Andy took a healthy swallow of his own and shrugged. You going to wait around for Maggie?
Do you think she'll talk to me?
Andy thought about it. Well, you pissed her off, so it's hard to say. Just what is it you're hoping she'll tell you, John? There was no easy answer to that, and John let the silence build for a few moments before he finally replied with a question of his own.
Why are all of you so convinced she's your best chance of catching this bastard? What is it that's so special about Maggie Barnes?
Andy leaned back in his chair until it creaked in protest and took another swallow of coffee. He studied the man across from him, wondering how much to say, wondering how much would be believed. John Garrett was a hard-headed, hard-nosed businessman who made a fortune by understanding the cold logic of finance. Andy hadn't known him long, but common sense told him John wasn't the sort of man to easily accept anything he couldn't see with his own eyes or hold in his hands. Andy?
Maggie has a knack, John. You can call it exceptional skill, or talent amounting to genius, or amazing empathy. But whatever you call it, the result is that she talks to shattered victims of crimes, and from the little they're able to tell her, she manages to give us a face we can look for. I didn't think police even used sketch artists anymore. Isn't their computer program just as good?
Not as good as Maggie.
She's that talented?
Andy hesitated, then sighed. Talent's only part of it, though she has that in spades. She could make a fortune as a real artist, but instead she spends her days sitting in cramped interview rooms listening to horror stories I hope you never have to listen to. She listens, and she talks to those people, and somehow she helps them relive a nightmare without letting it destroy them. And then she comes out and starts drawing, and 9 times out of 10 gives us a sketch so accurate the guy could use it on his driver's license.
Sounds like magic, John said dryly.
Yeah, it does, doesn't it? Looks like it sometimes, too. I don't know how she does it. Nobody here knows how she does it. But we've learned to trust her, John.
Okay. Then why doesn't she have a sketch of the rapist yet?
Because not even Maggie can work with nothing. The women haven't seen anything. And besides that, the first victim died before anybody could talk to her. The most recent one is still in the hospital. And you saw what kind of shape Ellen Randall's in.
You didn't mention Christina,
John forced himself to say. Andy gazed at him steadily. I didn't think I had to. She did the best she could for us, but she didn't see anything either.
Maggie Barnes talked to her, didn't she? That's what you told me, what the report said.
Yeah, she talked to Christina.
Without witnesses?
Slowly, Andy frowned.
Without anybody in the observation room, if that's what you mean. Then maybe she can tell me something none of the rest of you can tell me.
Like what?
Like why Christina killed herself.
Chapter 2. As she'd expected, Maggie quickly found that Ellen Randall had withdrawn again into her frozen shell. Pushing her would only make matters worse. So Maggie didn't protest when Lindsay announced she was taking her sister home, and she didn't try to arrange another meeting. Even though she could hear the clock ticking away in her head, time was running out. She knew it. She felt it. And every day that passed, with the police no closer to catching the animal the newspapers had begun calling the blindfold rapist, brought them closer and closer to another victim. Another life ruined. Another soul marked. Worse, Maggie knew that he would only become more violent as time passed. It would take more cruelty to satisfy whatever unnatural hunger drove him to do what he did. Soon, very soon, he would begin killing his victims. And when that happened, and the police were denied even the shaky recollections of living victims, then they would have no chance at all of stopping him, unless and until he made a mistake. So far, he hadn't made a single one. Maggie glanced into the bullpen and saw John Garrett sitting at Andy's desk. She didn't want to talk to Garrett. Not now. Not yet. She retreated to an unoccupied office near the interview rooms and sat down with her sketch pad open before her. There was very little on the page, just a vague shape of a face surrounded by hair so long that Maggie suspected he'd worn a wig. At their first meeting a few days before, Ellen Randall had given Maggie that much. Longish hair. She'd felt it brush her skin when he bent over her. But no other useful details. Nothing for her to build on. Maggie had no feeling for the shape of the face, whether his forehead was high or low, his jaw strong or weak, his chin jutting or receding. She didn't even know if his complexion was smooth or rough. Both Ellen and one other victim thought they remembered the touch of cool, hard plastic covering his face, as though he'd worn a mask. Just the possibility disturbed Maggie, on a level as much instinctive as it was analytical. What man would be so wary of discovery, of being identified, that he would wear a mask even after blinding his victims? Of course, criminals seldom wanted to be identified. But Maggie had talked to the cops working on the investigation, and all of them agreed that this particular criminal was going to unusual extremes to protect his identity. Why? Was there something about his face even a blinded victim could recognize when it touched her? Scars, perhaps, or some other kind of deformity? Maggie? She didn't look up, and swore silently at him for disrupting a mental musing that had often, in the past, produced results for her. Hey, Luke. He came into the office and sat down in the visitor's chair across from hers. Any luck? No, unless you count bad luck. She closed the sketch pad with a sigh. Ellen froze up again. We were interrupted, and it broke the connection I was trying to establish. I'll have to wait a few days and then get her back in here. I just talked to Hollis Templeton's doctor, Drummond said. She's doing even better than he'd hoped, physically at least. He's hopeful the surgery was a success. If it was, if she can see again, then maybe...
Maybe what?
Maggie looked at him steadily. Maybe she'll be a little less traumatized and able to help us? It's possible, Maggie.
Yeah. Yeah, I know it is.
It's also possible she noticed things the other victims wouldn't have, since she was an artist, I mean. Would you go try to talk to her? She hasn't said shit to any of us. She might talk to you.
I'd rather wait until she leaves the hospital. The atmosphere there isn't exactly conducive to the kind of conversation I need.
I know, but there's a lot of pressure, more every day. The newspapers, citizens' groups, the mayor. There's a panic building out there, Maggie, and I can't stop it. Get me something I can use to stop it.
I can't work miracles, Luke.
You have before. She shook her head.
That was different. This guy is determined his victims will never testify against him. He's not letting them see him. He doesn't speak to them. He makes damn sure they don't get their hands on him. The only sense left is smell, and so far all I've got is that he smells like ivory soap. Deliberately, of course. He's using the scent of the soap to block anything else they might smell.
Yeah, I know he hasn't missed a trick so far, but, like you said, his most recent victim was an artist, and I'm told artists are trained to use their senses differently from most of the rest of us. Hollis Templeton might be able to give you more to go on. Try, Maggie. Please.
She had stopped wondering if he had any idea what he asked of her, of the victims. He didn't. Luke Drummond was a fair cop, an able administrator, and a good politician. But he didn't have much in the way of imagination or empathy, not when it came to victims. Did he even guess she was as much a victim as the women she talked to? No, probably not. "I'll go over there tomorrow," she said. "But if she won't talk to me, I can't press her, Luke. You know that."
"Just try. That's all I ask."
He got to his feet, visibly relieved. She could almost see him silently deciding what he was going to tell the chief of police and the mayor. He wouldn't mention her by name, of course. Just say that they were pursuing a good lead in the investigation. It wasn't that Luke Drummond didn't want to share the credit. It was just that he mistrusted what he didn't understand. And he didn't understand how she did what she did. He wouldn't have understood even if she had explained it to him. And she had no intention of doing that. "I'll try," Maggie said, because there was nothing else he would hear.
"Great. Hey, have you talked to Garrett yet?"
"No, not yet."
"He's waiting out in the bullpen, I think."
"Yeah, I know."
Drummond looked down at her with a little frown. "Don't tell him any more than you have to. He might have the mayor and the chief in his hip pocket, but I don't like civilians being handed all the details of an ongoing investigation."
"Such as they are,"
Maggie murmured. "You know damn well we're holding back a few things publicly, like the ivory soap bit. I'm just saying I'd rather we kept this stuff within the unit, to rule out copycats, if nothing else. I'm serious, Maggie."
"I know you are. Don't worry. John Garrett doesn't want to talk to me about things like that."
Drummond had started to turn away, but paused as his attention was caught by what she'd said. "I thought you hadn't talked to him yet."
"I haven't."
"Then how do you..." He broke off and frowned. "Oh, yeah. I guess it makes sense. He'd have only one thing on his mind, at least when he's talking to you. You were the last one to talk to Christina Walsh, weren't you?"
"So they tell me."
"I read the report," he said unnecessarily. "Garrett read it. I don't know what the poor bastard thinks you can tell him."
"I don't know either," Maggie said, lying.
"Tread lightly, Maggie. He can cause us a lot of trouble if he wants to."
She nodded, but didn't say anything else, and Drummond left her alone in the office. Pushing John Garrett from her mind, at least for the moment, she opened her sketch pad again and stared down at the vague outline of a man's face. "Who are you?" she murmured. "Who are you this time?"
Andy said, "I doubt Maggie knows the answer to why Christina killed herself, John. She hasn't mentioned it, and I think she would have." "Maybe not. If it had nothing to do with your investigation, she might have kept it to herself."
Carefully, wary of what he knew was still an opened wound, Andy said,
"John, after what happened to Christina, suicide was probably the only option she felt she had left. His other victims didn't kill themselves. He didn't do to them what he did to her, you know that. The bastard was apparently still experimenting with ways of blinding his victims, and that acid did more than take her sight. Jesus, John, I know a lot of strong men who would have taken the same way out under those circumstances." "Not Christina." John's voice was level, with a sort of control that was about as stable as nitro. "As bad as things were, it would have taken more, much more, before she gave up. She was one of the strongest people I've ever known. I'm absolutely certain of that, Andy." "Okay. But everybody has a breaking point, and none of us can be that sure of somebody else's. I'm just saying. Don't expect too much from Maggie." "All I expect is the truth."
Andy grimaced.
"Well, I'm pretty sure you'll get it from her. If she talks to you at all,
She'll tell you the truth as she sees it, but...
But?
If you want my advice, and you probably don't, you'll be careful how you ask. Maggie's very independent, John. And I mean on the prickly side. From what I've seen, she doesn't take any shit from anybody, no matter who they are. I don't think you could piss her off to the point that she'd walk away from her work here. But I'd rather not take any chances. She's committed to helping us, and I'd like to keep it that way.
Why?
Why would I like to keep it that way?
Why is she so committed to helping you? You said yourself she has to listen to horror stories, that she could make a fortune as an artist. So why does she do this instead?
I don't know.
You've never asked her?
Sure I have. So have some of the others. But whatever her reasons are, they're obviously private. This time, take my advice, and don't go there.
It wasn't in John's nature to accept being warned off, not when he was curious, and not when he was feeling an unaccustomed sensation of frustrated helplessness about this entire situation. But all he said was, "I'll keep that in mind." Andy knew when he was being humored.
Yeah, yeah.
Look, you want more lousy coffee?
I just want to talk to Maggie Barnes.
I saw Ellen Randall and her sister leave a little while ago, so Maggie's probably free. But I don't know...
I'm free,
Maggie said from just behind John's left shoulder.
You wanted to speak to me, Mr. Garrett?
He got to his feet quickly. If you can spare me a few minutes, I'd appreciate it. Drummond's office is empty right now, Andy offered. He's headed across town for a meeting.
With who?
Maggie asked. Dunno, but probably another citizens group. He's catching a lot of heat, Maggie.
He told me.
Yeah, I'll just bet he did. Maggie shrugged.
Can't really blame him for pushing, or for not understanding he didn't have to.
Andy sighed in agreement. Maggie turned away, clearly assuming John would follow her as she led the way to Luke Drummond's office. When they went in, she took one of the visitor's chairs in front of the desk, shifting it so that it faced the other one. After closing the door behind them, John took the other one and turned it as well. The closed door would keep them from being overheard, but that was the extent of privacy. The partitions between this office and the bullpen were glass from the waist up, and though there were blinds... all were wide open. John was aware of several curious stares directed their way, but Maggie didn't seem to notice.
"I don't know what you expect to learn from me, Mr. Garrett," she said. "There's nothing I can tell you that isn't in any of the numerous reports I'm sure you've read."
He caught himself listening to her voice more than what she said, trying to identify that elusive sense of half-remembered song. "I know what's in the reports." She nodded and looked down at the sketch pad in her lap.
"Then you know it all."
She really didn't want to talk to him like this. She didn't want to have to answer the question she knew he wanted to ask her. "Miss Barnes." He shook his head. "Look, I'll be around until this bastard is stopped, even if I'm not officially part of the investigation, so why don't we drop the formality? My friends call me John." She made herself look at him and nod again, tried to distract herself with an artistic automatic inventory. He was a good-looking man, in a commanding sort of way. Big, broad-shouldered, athletic, or at least worked to stay in good shape. Undoubtedly, both impressive and formidable in a business suit. The more casual jeans and black leather jacket lent him a slightly dangerous air that was probably, Maggie thought, not the least bit deceptive. His hair was very dark, but she knew there'd be a hint of red in the sunlight. Eyes an unusual shade of blue-green, and a deep set beneath brows that flared slightly upward at the outer corners so perfectly an artist might have drawn them. He'd look mean as hell when he scowled, she thought idly. Probably be mean as hell mad.
but there was humor in the curve of his mouth, in the laugh lines fanning out from his eyes, and more than enough intelligence and self-control in those eyes to mitigate whatever temper he had. Most of the time, anyway.
"Okay, John it is. I'm Maggie," she said, wishing she hadn't been here today, or he hadn't. Anything to postpone this conversation a little longer. "But I still can't tell you anything about the investigation that you don't already know."
"That isn't what I wanted to talk to you about. At least, not directly." He drew a breath. "There's something I wanted to ask you."
She hadn't intended to, but Maggie found herself nodding. "Yes. About Christina."
"I guess it's not so surprising that I'd want to ask you about her,"
he said after a moment. "No, but there's nothing I can tell you." Until that moment, Maggie hadn't known what she would say. She hadn't known she would lie. It required an effort to keep meeting his eyes steadily.
"You were the last person to see her, the last one to speak to her before she died."
"I interviewed her, just the way I interviewed Ellen Randall today. Asked her questions, asked her to relive what had happened to her. It was painful for her."
"So painful she decided to kill herself 12 hours later?" John demanded, his voice suddenly harsh. Maggie didn't blink or flinch.
"It wasn't our first interview.
We were going over what we'd discussed before. There was nothing new. No new impressions from her. No new questions from me.
She seemed the same as always when I left."
"You left her alone?"
She did flinch at that. "The nurse had always been there, in the next room. I assumed she was there that day, even though I hadn't seen her. I didn't find out until later."
John relented, uncertain in his own mind whether it was because he knew she wasn't to blame or because that haunting voice of hers affected him in a surprisingly powerful way. "You couldn't have known what she'd do. She was always a very good actress."
He gazed into those strange cat eyes and had the sudden realization that here was another woman entirely capable of hiding her thoughts.
But before he could do more than wonder if he wanted to pursue that, she spoke again in the same level tone.
"In any case, there's nothing helpful I can tell you. I'm sorry you wasted your time."
"I didn't waste it. I've wanted to meet you since Andy first told me they had a uniquely talented sketch artist working on the investigation. I'm curious about how you work, which is why I barged in on your interview today. I'm really sorry about that, by the way." She didn't respond to the apology, other than with a brief nod.
"There's nothing extraordinary about the way I work. It's the way sketch artists have always worked. I talk to victims, ask them questions, gain impressions, and then I draw what I think they saw. Sometimes I get lucky."
"According to Andy, it's more than luck. And more than just sometimes."
Maggie shrugged. "Andy's a friend. He's biased."
"And is the police chief also biased? He was singing your praises to me yesterday."
She dropped her gaze briefly to the sketch pad in her lap, then said in a matter-of-fact tone, "His niece was abducted from her school playground about 5 years ago, and I helped them find the guy before he could hurt her."
"With a sketch? There were witnesses?"
"The other kids. The oldest was only 9, so it was difficult. Kids tend to elaborate, to invent details using their imaginations, so we had to weed through what they said they saw to get at the truth."
"How were you able to do that?"
Maggie hesitated only an instant. "I listened to them."
"And you knew truth from elaboration? How?"
"I don't know. I mean, I don't know how to explain it. Andy calls it intuition. Instinct. I guess that's as good a word as any. I've been doing this a long time. Surprised, John said,
It can't have been all that long. You're, what, 25?
Thanks, but it's 31. The first time I sketched a face for the police, I was 18, so I've been doing this almost half my life.
Isn't 18 awfully young to work for the police?
I wasn't working for them then, not officially. Maggie sighed. I happened to witness a crime, and I was the only one present who saw anything. I also happened to be able to draw. One thing led to another, and by the time I was in college, I was also officially on the police payroll. John had one more question, but before he could ask them, Andy knocked on the door and opened it to say, Sorry for the interruption, but... Maggie, we just got a call. Hollis Templeton says she'll talk to you Saturday afternoon at the hospital. Maggie got to her feet.
She called us?
Yeah, after ignoring us for weeks.
Did she say why?
No, but... Andy shifted his weight the way he did when he was uneasy. You two haven't met, right?
Right.
Know each other by reputation?
I don't know her work. Don't see how she could know mine. Why?
She asked for you by name, Maggie. Said she'd only talk to you. John got up.
Why is that strange?
He asked. Because, Andy said, none of us has told her Maggie's name, and there's been no publicity about her being our sketch artist. We keep that quiet. So Hollis Templeton really shouldn't have known who to ask for.
Friday, November 2nd. The hotel room in Pittsburgh was like every other hotel room he'd ever stayed in. And Quentin Hayes wondered idly if there was a Hotel Decorators Association, and they met secretly two or three times every year to decide what all the hotel rooms in America were going to look like. Because, surely, it was beyond coincidence that they all used variations of the same floral print bedspreads and drapes, and hung the same bland landscapes on the walls, and arranged the furniture in the most unreasonable way so that there was never an outlet where one was needed, and it was always necessary to unplug a lamp in order to plug in a computer or fax machine. No, it was obviously a conspiracy. He expressed that opinion to his companion, and she gave him a wry response.
You've been on the road too long,
Kendra Elliott said.
That does not, Quentin said, negate the probability I'm right.
Kendra typed another sentence into her report, keeping her gaze on the laptop, even as she said,
A vacation. That's what you need. A nice, long one. A couple of weeks spent not chasing after bad guys or coming up with imaginative reasons to explain how you know the things you know.
How can you talk and type at the same time? If I try that, I end up typing what I'm saying.
My uniquely flexible mind. I'm telling Bishop you need a break.
Change of scene is what I need.
Quentin lay back on the bed and clasped his hands together behind his neck, resting his blonde head against the headboard.
I'm tired of this place. It's going to snow tonight.
According to the weather reports?
No. It's going to snow.
She glanced at him, then continued typing.
Well, we should be able to get out before the bad weather moves in.
Right?
Mmm.
And maybe our next assignment will be someplace warm and sunny.
Mmm.
Kendra stopped typing, this time turning in her chair to study him. He appeared to be looking at the ceiling, but she knew that inward-turned gaze, the utter stillness, and waited patiently. Finally, softly, Quentin said, Shit. Trouble? He sat up, raked his fingers through his rather shaggy hair, and swore again beneath his breath.
He looked at his cell phone lying on the nightstand, and 5 seconds later, it rang. Kendra lifted an eyebrow but went back to her report. Quentin answered the phone.
Hey, John.
I wish you wouldn't do that,
John Garrett said.
Answer the phone? It rang, so I answered it. That's what they're for, you know.
I know what they're for, and you know what I meant. Even if you do know it's me calling, I wish you'd pretend otherwise. But that would be denying my deepest self,
Quentin said solemnly. John sighed. Quentin grinned, then said,
Okay, okay. But it's just so much fun to poke holes in your certainties.
Oh, is that what you've been doing all these years?
It's what I've been trying to do, without visible results.
One of these days, my friend, you're going to admit that there are more things in heaven and earth than you can find in those balance sheets of yours.
I never denied that.
No, you just deny precognition.
How can you see something that hasn't happened yet? John demanded.
I don't see anything. I just know what's going to happen before it happens.
Bullshit. I knew you were going to call. Lucky guess.
Quentin laughed.
Yeah. I just guessed it'd be you calling on a Friday morning in November when we haven't talked for more than a month. Use that hard head of yours and admit the paranormal exists.
It held the sound of an old argument, and Kendra tuned out Quentin's side of it until something he said a couple of minutes later caught her attention and made her realize the friendly debate was over.
Again? So it's 4 victims now?
He shook his head.
I had no idea, John. We've been caught up in something in Pittsburgh for the past few weeks, and I've barely looked at a newspaper.
They're sure it's the same guy?
They're sure.
He's still blinding his victims, for one thing. And I've got a hunch there are a few more similarities they haven't put in their reports. At least, not the reports I've seen.
You said the detectives handling the investigation were good.
Not good enough. Quentin, they don't know a bit more than they did when Christina died. And that was 3 months ago. 2 more women have been maimed for life, and the cops don't even have a decent description they can broadcast so the rest of the women in Seattle know who to be wary of. It isn't a real fun time to be a man in this city, I can tell you that.
You're staying out there?
For the duration.
Surprised, Quentin said, I know all those companies of yours practically run themselves these days, but is it wise for you to spend so much time away from L.A.?
I can fly down if I have to. I need to be here, Quentin.
Okay. But the cops there may not be happy to have you breathing down their necks, John. Why don't you back off and give them room to work?
They can't work when they have nothing to work with.
John drew a breath.
If you're really convinced that this new FBI unit you're with can get results using unconventional methods, then now's the time to prove it. The usual 5 senses aren't accomplishing a goddamn thing.
Quentin frowned. Have you persuaded the lieutenant in charge to call us in?
Not exactly.
By not exactly, do you mean he's wavering? Or do you mean this is all your idea?
The latter. Oh, hell, John. Look, I know it should come through official channels, but the lieutenant in charge is stubborn as a mule, and he's not going to yell for help until he's up to his ass in outraged citizens. So far, he's handling the flak and pushing his own people to work harder. But with nothing to go on, all they can do is sit around and wait for this bastard to make a mistake. That means more victims, Quentin.
I know what it means. But this is out of our jurisdiction. You know that. And without an official request for help made through official channels, the Bureau is not going to send us in. We're walking a tightrope as it is, bending over backward to be careful as hell every time we are called in, so the locals don't get the peculiar idea that we use witchcraft to solve their crimes.
I won't let you be burned at the stake.
Very funny.
Quentin sighed and looked across the room to find Kendra watching him with raised brows and her patent, don't do anything you'll regret, expression.
He sighed again.
You've still got political juice there, right? Can the mayor or governor put pressure on the chief of police to call us in?
They're reluctant. The lieutenant has some juice of his own, and he wants his team to handle this.
Because he's a good cop and sure of his team?
No, because he wants to sit in the governor's mansion himself one day.
Shit.
Yeah. I just don't think he's going to ask for help, Quentin. At least not officially.
I knew you were going to say that.
Then you know what I'm going to say next. You've probably got vacation time coming.
John's voice was persuasive. Spend some of it here. You haven't been home except for flying visits in years. I'll pay the tab. Send the jet for you. Best hotel suite, you name it.
Best hotel suite, huh? Quentin gazed around at the repressively unoriginal decor of the room he was in.
Kendra murmured, Oh, God.
John was saying, Absolutely the best. Say the word and I'll send the jet.
Where did you say you are?
Pittsburgh.
Why?
Quentin almost laughed at his friend's astonished tone. I told you we had a case. Unfortunately, it was here.
Is the case over?
Yeah. We won in overtime.
Good. Then you most certainly need a break.
I'll agree with that much. But I'm not sure I can take one right now, John. It all depends on whether there's another assignment waiting for me. Let me check with the office and I'll get back to you.
All right. Call me on my cell. I'll let you know something by this afternoon, I hope. Talk to you then, John.
Quentin turned off his phone and set it on the nightstand. Patiently, Kendra said, We aren't supposed to work unofficially, Quentin. You know that.
I know that.
Bishop won't like it.
I know that, too.
Kendra sighed. Seattle, huh?
He smiled slowly.
Seattle. Because he's your friend?
Yes. And because his sister was.
Chapter 3. Since she was forced to wait until Saturday afternoon to see Hollis Templeton, and knew better than to try arranging another interview with Ellen Randall so soon, Maggie found herself at loose ends on Friday. Her small house was too quiet, and the bright studio where she painted held no appeal. So late in the morning she picked up the sketch pad that went virtually everywhere with her, and drove across town to another small, rather shabby house. She went around to the back door that was never locked, pushing it open and called out a hello.
Studio, he called back.
Maggie picked her way through the usual clutter of books, magazines, newspapers, and half-finished craft projects to the studio, in addition to the house that was in stark contrast to the rest. Not only was it roomy and very bright due to the numerous windows and skylights, it was also extremely neat and well-organized, with paints and brushes stored precisely and canvases stacked in wooden bins. Various props and materials for drapes were kept ready on shelves between the windows, and the assorted chairs, lounges, and tables often used for backgrounds were arranged simply to comfortably furnish the large room. In the center of the room, an artist worked at an easel on a nearly completed canvas. The subject was a woman, and though she wasn't present in the flesh, it was clear from the charcoal sketches pinned to another easel nearby that she had posed more than once for the artist. The artist himself was about 30, a tall and lanky man with the face of an angel, or so Maggie had always thought. She'd never seen an angel, but she had seen traffic literally stop and mouths drop open when this man walked by, and they figured he was about as close to heavenly perfection as earthly mortals were likely to get. He had long wheat-gold hair he wore tied back at the nape of his neck, and his faded jeans and work shirt were, as usual, flecked with paint.
"Half a minute," he said without looking at her, his attention fixed on the careful shading beneath his subject's left ear.
"Take your time.
I was tired of my own company and just came to visit, Maggie said. He sent her one quick glance from very pale blue eyes that were almost unnervingly discerning, then continued with his work.
Not like you to be bored, he said.
Maggie sat down at a clean but scarred wooden table and watched him.
Not bored, exactly. Restless. I'm supposed to go talk to the most recent victim tomorrow, and until then there isn't a whole hell of a lot I can do. It's very wearing on the nerves, just sitting around waiting for the next attack.
I warned you, he murmured.
I know you did.
But why didn't you also warn me that Hollis Templeton would ask for me by name? He stopped working and looked at her steadily.
Nobody told her your name?
No.
What do you know about her?
Maggie shrugged. She's an artist, but she's new in Seattle, and I think the work she did on the East Coast was mostly commercial stuff, so we wouldn't have heard of her. Late 20s, single. From the photo I saw, she was attractive before the attack. I don't know about now.
He took her eyes.
Yes.
Removed them, very neatly, according to her doctors. No acid, this time. He used a knife or scalpel and seems to have known what he was doing.
Little damage to the optic nerve, to the eye socket and eyelids, which is why they decided to try the transplant.
Was it successful?
You tell me.
He smiled slightly and turned back to his painting.
I hate it when you do that, Maggie told him.
Do what?
His tone was innocent. Ignore a question. I start really dreading it when you don't want to answer.
Whether Hollis Templeton sees again is entirely up to her.
Well, that's cryptic enough. Did they teach you to talk like that in seer school?
I didn't go to seer school.
Prognosticator's school, then?
He chuckled. That either.
When it became clear he wasn't going to say anything else, at least for the time being, Maggie sighed and opened her sketchpad. For several moments she stared at the vague outline of a rapist's face, then swore beneath her breath and closed the pad again.
I really hate this, Beau, she said.
I know you do. I'm sorry.
But not sorry enough to be a little less cryptic.
Being sorry has nothing to do with it.
Free will.
He nodded and stepped away from the easel to begin cleaning his brushes.
Free will. You have to make the decisions and choices facing you of your own free will.
Maggie watched him broodingly.
And yet you know what those decisions and choices are going to be, which argues that fate is set, my destiny planned, and there is no such thing as free will.
Then let's call it the illusion of free will.
You can be very maddening sometimes, you know that?
You tell me so often enough.
Beau disappeared into the kitchen for a few minutes and returned with two canned soft drinks.
This stuff is very bad for us, he said vaguely. I read it somewhere.
He handed her a can and sat down across from her to pop the top of his own. Maggie followed suit.
You swear to me you can't tell me who the rapist is?
Beau frowned.
There's no sense of identity. And I can't see his face. That's something I would tell you if I could, Maggie. Believe me. There's nothing in the Seer's handbook about protecting monsters.
He is that, you know. Inhuman.
I know.
I have to stop him.
You mean you have to try?
Yes. Yes. Of course that's what I mean.
You're helping, Maggie.
Am I? I don't have a sketch yet.
Maybe not. But you're helping those women. If they have any kind of a life when this is over, it'll be largely due to you.
Then why don't I feel better?
Quietly, he said,
because you've let yourself get too close to them. You won't be able to do this much longer if you don't back away a bit. Try to stop feeling everything they feel.
Teach me how to do that, and I'll give it a shot.
She laughed, but the sound held no amusement. We're running out of time. It's only going to get worse from here on out, Bo. We both know that. Even so, stop trying to carry all of the load yourself. You can't do this alone. I've told you. You have to trust someone else to help you.
Someone other than you.
I'm outside the loop. My job is to offer cryptic warnings, remember?
Yeah, right.
Bo smiled slightly, but it was sympathetic rather than humorous.
I wish I could do more.
Then do more, damn it! The Seer Handbook, remember? We all have to play by the rules, Maggie. Put one foot carefully in front of the other, testing the ground, feeling our way, studying the signs. So wary of doing something that might make things even worse. You've been doing that, too. Otherwise, you would have told them the truth a long time ago.
And how am I supposed to tell them the truth? Andy, the other cops, how will they ever understand? Hell, how will they even believe me?
When you don't quite believe it yourself, he murmured.
It isn't an easy thing to believe, to accept.
I know.
You could be wrong about it, she said, more of a question than a statement.
I really wish I was, Maggie, for your sake.
He watched her for a moment in silence, then said,
Is Garrett here yet?
Yes. He was at the station yesterday. Wanted to talk to me about Christina.
Did you tell him?
The truth?
No.
I lied. I looked that man in the eye and lied to him about his sister's death.
Why?
Because... I don't know why. Because he wouldn't suffer less for knowing the truth. Because he'd blame himself for something he did or failed to do. Because Christina wouldn't want him to know. Because he wouldn't believe me.
She lifted her drink in a mocking salute.
Or maybe just because I'm a coward.
I don't think that was it.
Don't you? I'm beginning to wonder. I'm afraid, Bo. I'm scared to death.
Of the future?
Of now. What if I'm not strong enough, or smart enough, or quick enough? I wasn't before.
You will be this time.
Is that from the seer, or just from you?
From me.
Maggie sighed. That's what I thought.
She brooded in silence for several minutes, then said abruptly,
Garrett, you're wrong about him.
Am I?
Yes.
Well, Bo said affably, I've been wrong before. Not often, mind you, but it has been known to happen.
Time will tell, won't it, Maggie?
Yeah, she said.
Yeah, time will tell.
Andy Brenner had been a cop almost 15 years. He loved the work, even though it had cost him his marriage, which wasn't exactly an unusual price for cops to pay. Half the guys in the department were either divorced or trying to make a second marriage work better than the first one had. And the female officers didn't seem to have it any easier. Like most of the spouses, Andy's had hated the long hours and lousy pay, the stress of knowing her husband waited in filth virtually every day and might not come home except in a flag-draped box. But, even more than that, Kathy had hated his commitment to his job. Well, Andy could hardly change that. Hell, he couldn't even apologize for it. A cop wasn't much good to anybody if he wasn't dedicated, was he? No. Which was why he was staying late yet again on this Friday night, going over files he'd already studied so many times the information was practically embedded in his brain cells. Only now there was nobody waiting for him at home, pacing the floor or drinking too much wine after a supper alone. Andy? He looked up. I thought you left hours ago, Scott. Scott Cowan shook his head. No,
Jen and I were just in the back digging through some of the old files. He was holding a dingy gray folder in his hands.
What the hell for?
Just following up on a hunch.
A hunch about what? The rapist?
Not, Andy thought, that there was much chance it was about anything else. The case possessed all of them these days.
Well, yeah.
So, let's hear it. Scott hadn't been a detective long enough to have a lot of faith in his hunches, and he reddened a bit under Andy's gaze.
Well, I know we fed all the information we've got on this rapist through the computer to look for similar crimes, but Jen and me were talking today and we started wondering about the old files. Some of those files go back 50 years and more, and none of the info is in the system.
Patiently, Andy said, I doubt our rapist was attacking women 50 years ago, Scott. That'd make him, what, 75 or 80 now? Not even a little blue pill could help a geezer like that get it up.
No, that's not the way we're thinking. Something the shrink said at the meeting yesterday. She said this rapist seemed to have his rituals well established, as if he'd been at this much longer than the 6 months we know he's been active. So we thought he might have found himself some ready-made rituals, copying a much older string of crimes.
Taking the information right out of our old files?
Not necessarily. Jen checked, and some of this stuff has been written up in books over the years, especially the unsolved crimes. It's a popular subject, Andy. You know that. And it's at least a possibility that our guy could be following somebody else's game plan, isn't it?
Anything's possible.
Andy pursed his lips for a moment as he considered the idea.
Not bad, Scott. It's an angle we haven't considered.
Find anything yet?
We're not sure.
Something else interesting?
Something peculiar. At least, we thought so. Maybe you can say different.
He opened the file and extracted a yellowed sheet of paper, which he handed across the desk.
Just for the hell of it, we started with the really old files, those from more than 50 years ago. Specifically from 1934. Jen found this in one of them, among some case notes of a murder investigation. Andy stared down at the sketch and felt a sensation he'd never felt before, as though a cold finger had trailed slowly up his spine. A heart-shaped face and delicate features, the long dark hair.
Who is this? I mean, who was she?
She was the victim, Andy. A young teacher, stabbed to death in an alley. Apparently she was pretty beat up, so much so that they used an artist to sketch her the way they figured she looked uninjured, just so they'd have something to show around while they tried to identify her. They found out who she was, all right, but the case was never solved.
Must be a coincidence. Andy muttered. The artist got it wrong, guessed wrong about how she really looked, or some kind of family tie.
What was her name?
Scott opened the folder again.
Her name was Pamela Hall, spinster, 22. No family in Seattle, at least not that the cops could discover.
Was she raped?
Yeah, she was. In those days, though, rape was seldom reported and never investigated, at least as far as I can tell. It was just mentioned by the doctor in his post-mortem notes. The cops treated it like a murder, pure and simple. They weren't looking for a sexual predator.
Jennifer Seaton joined them at Andy's desk in time to hear that and said, "I don't think that term even existed then." She shook her head. More in weariness than anger. They still thought rape was a forceful act of sex, and nothing more.
"Have you found any other attacks around the same time?" Andy asked.
Jennifer shook her head again.
"Not yet, but this one happened early that year, and there are more files we can go through. We just thought we should check with you before we go any further. It wasn't the attack itself that caught my attention. Lots of women were killed in Seattle around that time. It was the sketch I couldn't get past. Andy drew a breath. I see what you mean. Shit, if this sketch is accurate, she was the image of our first victim, Laura Hughes. That's what we thought. Andy propped the sketch against his phone and stared at it. Probably just coincidence. Hell, it had to be. Still. Look, it's late. You two should go home. But when you come back on duty, you might want to keep digging in those files. See if you turn up anything else. Scott nodded, eager to participate more fully in an investigation where, so far, he'd been more of a glorified gopher than anything else. Sure, I can do that. Jen? Gladly. Beats the hell out of sitting at my desk taking call after call from panicky citizens. Scott said, Hey, Andy, you think we might have something here? Maybe this guy is copying old crimes by hunting for look-alike victims. Maybe, Andy said. But let's not get too excited just yet, okay, guys? One sketch doesn't mean much. Except maybe that all of us have, or had, doubles in the world. Just keep digging, and bring me anything you find. You bet, Andy. Want us to leave this file for you? Yeah. Andy accepted the file and wished the younger cops a good night. They walked out together, talking, and he wasted a minute or so wondering if they were sleeping together. Not very surprising, if so, and they wouldn't be the first pairing in the department. But he hoped they were smarter than that. When he was alone again, he stared at the sketch of a young woman long dead and gone. Hell, twice dead and gone. Or at least that was how it looked. Pamela Hall, stabbed to death in 1934 after being brutally raped. Laura Hughes, brutally raped and beaten in 2001, blinded, dying days later of her injuries. The two women didn't just resemble each other. They were virtually identical, right down to the little mole at the left corner of their mouths. But an artist had drawn this sketch with only the battered face of the victim as a guide, and Andy reminded himself that artists were hardly infallible. Except for Maggie, anyway. Andy combed through the file, but it held precious little information. From the sound of their notes, the investigating cops had been saddened by the murder of this young woman, but not surprised. She had been found in the bad part of town, and it was clear they considered it her own fault that she had placed herself in the path of danger. Still, they had investigated methodically for a while, and then moved on to the next crime demanding their attention. The post-mortem notes were no more helpful. The victim had died of blood loss and shock. There was evidence of forcible sexual activity, and she was beaten and bruised. It was the opinion of the doctor that she had fought her attacker, evidenced by the injuries to her arms and hands, but her strength had clearly been no match for his. Andy went back to studying the sketch. Were Scott and Jennifer right in their speculation? Was their modern-day serial rapist choosing his victims from old unsolved cases? It was, of course, ridiculous to base an assumption such as that one on a single example. But Andy couldn't help doing a little speculating himself. So far, they hadn't been able to find any pattern in the means or reasoning their rapist had used to choose his victims. Since one of the women had been abducted from a crowded shopping mall and another from her high-security apartment building, they had ruled out simple ease of access, which meant he was picking his victims some other way, and quite deliberately. Could he be using old unsolved investigations? And if he was, had he found the information he sought in books, or in the actual files themselves? If he was, Andy hoped it was the former. He really hoped so. Because he was pretty sure that the only people who could have gained access to the old files without attracting notice were cops. Saturday, November 3rd.
Maggie wasn't terribly surprised to find John Garrett at the hospital when she arrived to talk to Hollis Templeton shortly after 2 o'clock. She also wasn't terribly happy about it.
"The interview will be private," she told him.
"I know that. I just thought we might be able to get a cup of coffee somewhere afterward. Talk." She didn't bother to explain that interviews such as this one usually left her feeling something less than sociable.
"I doubt I'll have any new information," she warned him instead. "The first interview with a victim seldom produces anything we can use."
"I understand that. I'd still like to talk. And there's someone I'd like you to meet." Maggie was curious enough about that to nod and say fine, that she'd meet him at the waiting area near the elevators when she was finished with her interview. Then she went on to Hollis Templeton's room, braced herself as well as she could, and knocked quietly before going in.
"Miss Templeton?"
"Yes." She was sitting by the window, her face turned toward it, even though bandages covered her eyes. She was dressed in jeans and a bulky sweater, much as Maggie was dressed herself, even to the comfortable running shoes. Her brown hair was short and styled for a casual look and ease of care. Nothing at all fussy about it. Maggie crossed the small room to stand by the empty chair apparently awaiting her.
"I'm Maggie Barnes."
"I see." Her face turned toward Maggie, and lips that bore a healing cut moved in a smile. "Well, I don't, really. Have you ever stopped to think about how many things we say using words like see and look, when we don't actually mean to describe doing anything visual?" Maggie slipped into the chair.
"I've thought about it a lot lately," she answered.
Hollis smiled again, her face seemingly unmarked except for the healing cut and those bandaged eyes. "Yes, I imagine in speaking to blinded victims you find verbal minefields all over the place. I'm Hollis, by the way. A ridiculous family name. My father tried to shorten it to Holly when I was small, but I hated that even more." Maggie had talked to too many victims of violent crime to find the conversation in any way strange. Some victims had to discuss irrelevant things first, partly to delay reliving the pain of what had happened to them, and partly to at least attempt to establish a feeling of normalcy. So she was able to respond easily and without impatience. "Most people think Maggie is short for Margaret, but it isn't. I've always been Maggie." "It's a good name. It means pearl. Did you know?"
"Yes."
"Hollis means lives by the holly trees." "What kind of name is that for a grown woman?" She shook her head, adding abruptly, "Dumb subject. And trivial. Sorry. I don't mean to waste your time."
"You aren't, Hollis. I'm glad you called us."
"Us?" She nodded as though a private thought had been confirmed. "So you do consider yourself one of the cops, huh?"
"I guess so."
"It can't be a fun job, listening to horrible stories about man's inhumanity to man."
"No, that part of it isn't fun."
"Why do you do it?" Maggie studied the other woman, noting the stiff posture, the hands still bearing faint scratches and fading bruises, gripping the arms of the chair tensely. Slowly, she said,
"I have a knack. I listen to disparate details and manage to put them together to form a picture. A face."
Hollis tilted her head slightly.
"Yes, but why do you do it?
Were you a victim once?"
"No."
"Somebody you cared about?" Maggie almost shook her head, then remembered Hollis couldn't see her. It was an odd surprise. She could almost feel a gaze, feel attention fixed on her so completely that it was as if the other woman could see her.
No, she murmured, answering the question even as she wondered if what she felt was her imagination or something more. Is it pity? If Hollis was expecting a swift denial, she didn't get it. Calmly, Maggie said, I imagine that's part of it. Pity, sympathy, whatever you want to call it. Hollis smiled. You're honest. Good. I try to be. A little laugh escaped Hollis, and truthful enough to know it isn't always possible to be completely honest with other people. A lesson sadly learned. Life is full of them. Abruptly, Hollis said, I know I'm the fourth victim. I remember reading in the newspapers that the first two were dead. Yes. But he didn't leave them dead. They died later. Laura Hughes died of her injuries. Christina Walsh killed herself about a month after she was attacked. Did either of them have kids? No. What about the third woman? She has a little boy. I hadn't even decided if I wanted kids. Now it's a decision I don't have to worry about anymore. Maggie didn't offer platitudes. Instead, she asked, Is that the worst of it for you? That there won't be any children of your own? I don't know. Her lips moved again in that small, brief smile. I guess it might depend on whether the transplant was a success. The doctor's confident, but I don't know what you learned in art school, but one of the things they taught us is that the eyes, like the spine, are hardwired into the brain. That's why there hasn't been a successful transplant before now. They can transplant corneas, of course, but not the eyeball. Or at least that's conventional medical wisdom. My doctor intends to become a pioneer. You'll be one too, Maggie reminded her. I'm not so sure I want to be, but I do want to see again, so I signed the papers. Any chance is better than none, right? I'd say so. Yeah, but nobody really knows what might happen. My body doesn't seem to be rejecting the eyes, but the odds against them working the way they're supposed to are pretty long. The funny thing is... What? She drew a little breath. They say when you lose a limb, you get phantom sensations, that you still feel the limb attached to you, moving, hurting. I've heard that. I asked my doctor if it was the same way with eyes. I don't think he quite got what I meant until I asked him if I should be able to move them, because that's the kind of sensation I feel, that the eyes are moving under the bandages, behind my eyelids. Like now, when I think about looking toward the door, I can feel them move. What did your doctor say? Then it was probably phantom sensations. There hadn't been time for the muscles and nerves to heal. That was just after the operation, so I guess he was right. But it still feels the same to me, those sensations. When will they take the bandages off? Another week. Until then, all I can do is sit here and wait. I never was very good at waiting. Is that why you called us? Maybe. If I could do anything to help them catch that monster, then I want to do it. She paused and swallowed hard. At least, that was the plan. Now I'm not so sure I can talk about it yet. I'm sorry, but... Hollis, it's all right. You have to do this in your own time and way. Look, why don't I come back tomorrow and we'll talk again? We'll talk about anything you want for as long as you want, until you're ready. If you don't mind. I don't. I'll see you tomorrow afternoon, okay? Thank you, Maggie. Hollis didn't move after the door closed behind her visitor. She turned her face back toward the window, thinking vaguely that if she'd been back in New England, she might have felt the sunlight on her face even in November. But the nurses had told her it was a typical Seattle day, overcast and dreary, with no sunlight to be had. They hadn't understood why she'd wanted to sit by the window anyway.
You should have talked to her, Hollis.
I did talk to her.
I told you that you could trust her.
She laughed under her breath.
I don't even know if I can trust you.
You know. All I know is that I'm creeping out the nursing staff by talking to someone who isn't there. I'm here. And you know I'm real.
Hollis turned her head so that she faced the chair across from her own.
If I could see, would I see you?
Perhaps.
And perhaps not. I think I'll make up my own mind who to trust, if it's all the same to you, Figment.
Make up your mind soon, Hollis. We're running out of time.
Chapter 4
I couldn't push her, Maggie said. I can't push her. We just have to wait until she's ready to talk about it.
And when will that be? John asked. He sat back to allow the waitress to serve their coffee, wondering if Maggie had suggested this coffee shop across from the hospital because she liked it or because she wanted to spend as little time with him as possible.
My guess is a few days. She's coping better than I expected, maybe because she has the hope of seeing again. But her emotional condition is still very fragile.
Did you ask her how she knew to ask for you by name?
No. I didn't want to ask anything that might have been interpreted as suspicious.
Bad for the rapport?
That's one way of putting it. If I can't establish a strong bond of trust, then she won't confide in me, especially as long as she can't see.
John didn't lack imagination, and it wasn't difficult for him to at least try to understand the terror of being suddenly locked away in darkness, especially as it applied to dealing with others.
No visual clues, he said slowly.
We use our eyes so much when it comes to weighing other people and judging the worth of what they tell us.
A little surprised, Maggie said. Exactly.
He smiled but didn't comment on her surprise. So you didn't learn how she knew about you. Anything else? Do you think she saw anything before he blinded her?
I don't know. She has something on her mind, but I have no way of knowing what that might be.
If she hadn't been gazing directly at his face, she wouldn't have seen his instant of hesitation and the decision to say what was on his mind.
So what we need, he said lightly, is a good psychic.
Have a few on the payroll, do you?
Her voice was matter-of-fact.
Not on my payroll, no. At least, not that I know of. But I have a friend who might be willing to help. Assuming he can, of course.
You doubt his abilities?
I, John said deliberately, doubt the entire concept, if you want the truth. I have a hard time believing in the so-called paranormal. But I've seen Quentin find answers when no one else could. And even if I'm not sure how he does it, at least his way is another option. Especially in a situation where there is so little information and so much need for more.
Maggie sipped her coffee to give herself a moment to think, then said, I'm pretty sure Luke Drummond would balk at having one more civilian officially involved in the investigation.
I'm positive he would, which is why Quentin can only be involved unofficially.
Which means access to the investigation is going to be a problem. Is that why you're telling me?
Do you expect me to get him access to the victims?
John immediately shook his head.
I wouldn't put you in that position or ask those women to talk to yet another stranger, especially a strange man. No. I'm telling you because from everything Andy said about you, my hunch is that you're going to be at the center of this investigation for the duration, And I don't mean sitting in an interview room downtown.
What do you mean?
Andy says you've walked the areas where the first three victims were found. True?
She nodded, slowly.
Why? Maggie couldn't think of a simple answer and finally shrugged.
To gather impressions, I suppose. I told you, a lot of what I do is intuition.
According to Andy, you always immerse yourself in an investigation. You don't just interview victims and witnesses or just study the crime scenes. You read all the reports, talk to the cops, comb through files, even hit the streets following up on your hunches. You talk to family and friends of the victims and construct your own diagrams of crime scenes. Andy swears he believes you have a filing cabinet tucked away somewhere at home with your own personal files of the investigations you've participated in. Maggie only just stopped herself from flinching.
Andy talks too much.
Maybe so, but did he lie? She laced her fingers together around her cup and stared down at it for a long moment, before finally meeting his gaze again.
Okay. So I get involved. What does that have to do with you and your friend?
I won't share confidential details of the investigation. I don't expect you to. Look, I can get most of the information on the formal investigation myself. At least as much as Andy can give me. What I'm asking you to do is to work separately, independently of the official investigation, with Quentin and me.
Maggie frowned at him. You're planning to run an independent investigation?
Why not? I have resources the police can't begin to match. I can go places they can't go, ask questions they'd be damned for asking.
Steadily, she said, as the brother of a victim?
His jaw tightened, but John nodded and replied calmly, as the brother of a victim. Nobody will be much surprised that I'm trying to find answers on my own, and most people will be sympathetic. We can use that if we have to.
Ruthless, she noted.
Practical, he disagreed. There's nothing cold-blooded about this, remember? That bastard destroyed Christina. He murdered her as surely as if he killed her with his own hands. I intend to see to it that he pays.
I don't think much of vigilante justice.
That isn't what I have in mind. If we get even a whiff of a viable suspect, we'll hand the information over to the police immediately. I don't want to do their job, Maggie. I promise you that. But I do believe the investigation needs a fresh start, a new slant. It's been 6 months since the first victim was attacked. Do you believe the police know much more today than they did then?
Reluctant, she said, no, not much more.
Neither do I.
Okay. But what makes you think we, can accomplish any more working independently?
Call it a hunch.
She shook her head. For a man who denies belief in the paranormal, you're putting a lot of faith in a hunch.
He smiled. No. I'm putting a lot of faith in Quentin. And in you. And I can't keep just waiting around twiddling my thumbs, Maggie. I have to at least try to find some way of putting this bastard behind bars before he attacks again.
She understood that drive all too well. But his plan still made her uneasy. Stalling for time, she said, "Don't you have a business empire to run?"
What I need to do, I can do by phone, fax, or modem. I've spent the past 6 weeks arranging things so that I could take time off for this.
And you expect me to take time as well?
I expect you to go on doing exactly what you would have done anyway, but with sometime companions.
John leaned forward a bit.
Useful companions. I wasn't kidding about having resources. But even more than that, we can help you with the legwork, case notes, research, whatever is needed. Quentin and I can share the load.
Stop trying to carry all of the load yourself. Maggie didn't have to wonder if it was a coincidence that Beau had used the same phrasing. There were few coincidences anywhere in his orbit. She drew a breath. And when Andy and the other cops find out I'm involved in a private parallel investigation, just how long do you expect it to take for them to slam the door in all our faces?
They won't do that, if we've made progress. And I expect us to make progress.
She swore under her breath and stared down at her coffee again.
You're going to investigate on your own anyway, aren't you?
Not yet ready to admit that she'd already started, Maggie shrugged. It was John's turn to swear, just as softly as she had.
If I thought money motivated you, I'd ask your price, but it doesn't. So what does motivate you, Maggie? What can I say to convince you to help me?
She finished her coffee and set the cup down, meeting his gaze with a sense of inevitability. You just said it. And before he could question her apparently sudden capitulation, she added, You're right. I'd investigate on my own anyway. Might as well make it a team effort. He reached across the table and covered her hand with his.
Thank you. You won't regret it. I promise you.
The physical contact caught her off guard, and for just that unprotected instant, before she could shut it out, she felt his determination as well as his conviction that she could help him. And she felt something else. Something warm and very male and disturbingly familiar. She sat back, gently drawing her hand away under the pretext of pushing her coffee cup to one side. What's the game plan? I assume you have one. John frowned briefly, as if something he couldn't quite define puzzled him.
The beginnings of one, anyway. Andy said you hadn't yet walked over the area where Hollis Templeton was found.
No, not yet.
That's as good a place as any to start. I've asked Quentin to meet us there.
As much as she hated to admit it, even to herself, Maggie had put off that chore because she dreaded what she knew awaited her there. What she wasn't sure of was whether having companions on the visit would make it better or worse. Still, maybe it was time to show John Garrett a glimpse of her magic, time for him to at least begin to understand. We don't have much daylight left, she said, keeping her tone brisk. I'm ready if you are. Well, Jennifer said, we definitely have something, but I'll be damned if I know what it is.
It's gotta be coincidence, Scott said. It's gotta be coincidence, right, Andy?
Andy didn't blame either of them for being bewildered. What they'd found, by mid-afternoon on Saturday, were three more files concerning murder investigations in 1934. All three victims were young women. All three had been brutally attacked, raped, and left for dead, and all three murders had gone unsolved. In two of the three folders they had found something more than scanty case notes. They had found sketches of the victims, sketches the police had used in identifying the women, again because their faces had been so badly battered, obvious in the grainy crime scene photos. One of the sketches was rather inexpertly done and hadn't, in fact, helped the police to identify the dead woman. She had gone nameless to a pauper's grave. But the second sketch was a good one, and had been backed up later once she was identified by a photograph. The victim had been the daughter of a local businessman, and not only had her reputation been spotless, but she had apparently been attacked not 20 yards from her own back door, in the best part of town. Her name had been Marianne Trask, and according to the sketch, she bore an uncanny resemblance to Hollis Templeton. The same medium brown hair and strong, attractive features, same oval face, same slender neck.
Not identical, Jennifer noted, but damned close.
But if you read the descriptions of the other victims, even without sketches to go by,
They sound a lot like Christina Walsh and Ellen Randall. Coincidence? I guess it could be.
It's arguable, Andy said. Four women attacked, and each case matches up with one of ours, at least as far as the description of the victim is concerned. But there are differences.
Yeah. All the 1934 victims died within hours.
Jennifer sighed and reached into her pocket for a cinnamon-flavored toothpick. She'd recently quit smoking and claimed chewing the toothpicks soothed her oral fixation. It was a mark of the respect in which she was held by the men that not one of them had ventured a lewd response, at least not out loud.
That's not all, Andy said. There's no mention in the case files of any of them being blinded.
Scott offered, that could be our guy's own personal twist. I mean, maybe he's trying to find look-alike victims but making damn sure they can't look at him.
In 1934, Jennifer pointed out, leaving them for dead did the trick, so that killer didn't have to worry about his victims even trying to identify him.
Why doesn't our guy kill his victims? Scott asked, directing the question to Jennifer. He goes to such pains to blind them. Wouldn't killing them outright be a hell of a lot easier?
Why ask me? She shifted the toothpick to the other side of her mouth and added, if I had to guess, I'd say he just hasn't been quite ready, so far, to cross the line into outright murder. But I'm no expert, and if you want my opinion, that's what we need on this case. Our shrink's good, but she's no profiler.
Andy grunted. Drummond won't call in the FBI, and you know how the chief feels about the officer in charge of an investigation making that decision.
If we can't solve this, he'll have to, Jennifer objected.
You don't know our Luke, Andy said sourly.
Jennifer rolled her eyes.
Oh, yes, I do. I just keep hoping I'm wrong, that's all.
Scott made a rude noise, not quite under his breath.
I wouldn't mind being wrong about that, she told him mildly.
Let's stick to business, Andy said. Four victims. That's it for the year?
Well, we aren't sure about that.
Jennifer traded looks with Scott and shrugged.
Files are missing, Andy.
What the hell do you mean, missing?
I mean that from June, just after the fourth victim was killed, through the end of that year, there are no files. The box is so packed, it's hard to say if files have been removed or were never there.
They had to be there, Jen, at least in 1934. Crime doesn't just stop in June to take a vacation.
She shrugged again. Well, they aren't there now.
Jeez, how many times since then do you figure the file boxes have been moved around? This isn't the original site of the investigating station, and even this building has been rebuilt or remodeled at least three times. As the city grew, the districts multiplied. Police records for Seattle are probably scattered over a dozen different buildings or more.
Scott sank down in Andy's visitor's chair and groaned. I never thought. But you're right. Every station probably has file boxes in its basement or storage rooms.
And none of it's on computer, Jennifer reminded them. It's taking all the manpower we can muster to get the modern records on computer for comparison. If the old stuff is ever part of the computerized record, it won't be any time soon.
Andy sat back in his chair and stared at the two sketches propped up against his lamp.
Two pretty conclusive matches, he said slowly, and descriptions of two more that sound close enough to be strong maybes. Four victims closely matching our four victims. You know, guys, I'd really like to see the files for the rest of that year. Maybe the year after.
Jennifer got it first. In case there are more rape murders?
You think if there were more victims then, we'll have more now? And maybe a shot at identifying would-be victims?
Hell, I don't know. Andy scowled. Even with sketches and photos, we don't have much hope of finding lookalikes in a city this big. But more files may give us more information, and God knows we could use it. So I say we look for them.
I just had a creepy thought, Jennifer said. What if this bastard is just yanking our chains, copying old crimes or picking lookalike victims only as long as we don't catch on?
How could he know we'd caught on? Scott objected.
If we manage to identify a potential victim, say.
One nightmare at a time, Andy told them. You guys want to get on the phone and try to track down those missing files?
The building where Hollis Templeton's bleeding body had been dumped wasn't precisely in the bad part of town. It was just somewhat isolated from the buildings nearest it, and in very bad shape. Intended for demolition so that a modern new apartment complex could rise in its stead, it had stood empty for at least 6 or 8 months. Maggie got out of her car and stood on the curb, absently hugging her sketch pad to her breast as she waited for John to park his car and join her. It was chilly, a restless wind whining around like something lost and alone, and the overcast sky was allowing darkness to approach even earlier than usual. Maggie hated this. She hated this lonely place, hated being here with darkness creeping ever closer. She hated the cold fear writhing in the pit of her stomach, and the dread that made her skin feel prickly, as though the nerves lay rawly exposed on the surface.
Maggie?
She started, despite herself, and tore her gaze from the broken rubble walkway leading to the building, to find John standing beside her.
Are you all right?
She nodded, quickly. Yes, of course. Just wool gathering. Where's your friend?
Well, since there's a rental car parked across the street, I'd say he's already here.
He studied her face, not quite frowning, but clearly bothered by what he saw.
Are you sure you want to go in there?
Want to?
No.
But I'm going in. He smiled faintly.
Determination, or just plain stubbornness?
Is there a difference?
Maggie didn't wait for him to answer, but walked steadily up the walkway to the building. John walked beside her. I've always thought so. Do you have a set pattern for going over crime scenes, or is everyone different?
I suppose each is different, and this isn't really a crime scene anyway. She was left here, but not attacked here.
He paused with her just a few feet from the doorway and looked down at her. But her attacker was here, if only long enough to leave her inside. Is that what you hope to pick up on? Intuitively?
As tense as she was, Maggie had to smile. You really are uncomfortable discussing intuition, aren't you?
The way you and Quentin appear to use it, yes.
I'm not psychic.
Sure about that?
Before Maggie could answer, a tall blonde man appeared suddenly in the doorway and offered a cheerful greeting.
I hope somebody brought a flashlight, because unless we're damn quick in here, we're going to end up in the dark.
I thought they taught you to always be prepared, John said.
That's the Boy Scouts. I wasn't a Boy Scout. Wasn't a Marine, either.
John didn't question the latter statement. Just sighed and said he had several flashlights in his car.
I knew you would. That's why I didn't bring any.
Don't start with me.
Maggie, this is Quentin Hayes, who claims to know things before they happen.
There was no scorn in his voice, merely a sort of amused mockery, and he left her to make what she would of the introduction while he returned to his car for the flashlights. So you're a seer? She asked.
Not in the true sense of the word, meaning one who sees. I don't, actually. No visions. He shrugged. I just know things, sort of the way most people tune into memory or bits of information they've learned. The difference is that when I tune in, it's often to the knowledge of something that hasn't happened yet.
That must be unsettling.
It took some getting used to.
He eyed her thoughtfully.
I hear they call what you do nothing short of magical.
That's not what I call it.
Oh? What do you call it?
An ability I've practiced nearly half my life to perfect. I happen to be able to draw. I also happen to be able to listen to people describe what they've seen and then draw it. Nothing magical about that. It was virtually automatic by now, this reasonable explanation of her abilities.
When you put it like that, Quentin said affably, it does sound perfectly normal, doesn't it?
Only because it is.
John returned to them then, handing out flashlights. Quentin, how long have you been here?
Half an hour, maybe a little longer. I went upstairs for a bit, following the path she took when she dragged herself out here.
Maggie said, it's still visible, isn't it? The blood?
She gripped the flashlight tightly with one hand and held her sketch pad close with the other. Quentin looked at her, and for just an instant she felt as if he'd reached over and touched her physically with a warm hand, even though he didn't move. But the moment passed, and he nodded, sober now.
I'm afraid so, at least in places. Dried and brown now, but still there. Those of us with vivid imaginations, or something more, can even smell it. I'm sorry, Maggie.
She wasn't certain if he was expressing sympathy or apologizing for something, and she decided not to ask. Instead, she said,
I want to see where he left her.
This way. Quentin turned, and they followed him into the building. Maggie was so accustomed to guarding herself that it usually required a conscious effort to open the barriers inside and let all her senses probe her surroundings. She didn't like any of the sensations, but by now, at least, knew what to expect when she reluctantly dropped her guard. With all the broken windows in the place, there was light enough to see, if not very well. Stairs rose upward along the right side of the foyer. A hallway stretched past the stairs toward the rear of the building, with doorways lining it, most of them gaping open because of missing or severely damaged doors. Peeling paint covered the woodwork, and stained wallpaper dangled in ragged strips from the walls. Fixtures such as doorknobs and lights had been removed, and all else of any possible value long ago carted out of the building, either legitimately or by vandals. Beneath her feet, creaking floorboards were barely covered by ancient linoleum, and the place smelled of dirt and mold and many years of cooking and living. And blood. Heavy, coppery, the stench rose up, threatening to choke her. All she saw on the floor was the faint brown trail Quentin had described, but what she smelled was something still warm and wet and sticky. Maggie tried to unobtrusively breathe through her mouth. Could Quentin really smell that, or had he only known that she could? According to the reports, John said, switching on his flashlight and shining it around them, the police found nothing here. At least nothing they considered evidence.
Just like his other dumping places, right?
Quentin's voice was as matter-of-fact as John's had been. He turned on his own flashlight and led the way to the stairs, walking beside the intermittent brown trail of dried blood. So they told me. Drummond claims to have a very efficient forensics team, and they have a solid reputation. According to their reports, they went over this entire building and searched a block in every direction. Nothing.
Nothing, Maggie thought, but Hollis Templeton's blood.
She concentrated on turning on her flashlight, on walking up the stairs behind Quentin and ahead of John, all of them avoiding the dried blood trail. She could feel the familiar inner quivering, the cold weight in the pit of her stomach, and her legs felt stiff, awkward, as they moved. At first distantly, she became conscious of twinges of pain and dull aches that slowly intensified until they throbbed inside her. The darkness came in flashes that lasted only a second or two, and Maggie climbed steadily without outwardly betraying the fleeting moments of blindness. The smell grew stronger. She had hoped
that more than 3 weeks would have made it all feel more distant and unreal, that she could get through this without exposing her pain to these two men, but that seemed increasingly unlikely. At the top of the stairs, Quentin pointed his flashlight toward the rear of the building, down a hallway. "She was left in a room at the back of the house. Odd, really. Why carry her upstairs at all? Why not just dump her downstairs?" Softly, hardly aware of speaking, Maggie said, "He wanted her to have to drag herself all that way." Almost as softly, Quentin asked, "Why did he want that?" Maggie walked past him, only dimly aware of the question. She followed the blood trail down the hallway, her light pointed at the floor, until she found herself in a room. Like the rest of the place, it was peeling paint and ancient wallpaper and not much else. A broken window allowed light into the room, though it wasn't much light. She walked to the center of the room and pointed her flashlight to one of the rear corners, where the blood trail ended and a roughly rectangular shape of less dusty floor hinted that something had lain there for a while. "There was a mattress," John said, his voice low but nevertheless startling in the silence. "It's where he left her. The police don't believe he brought it here, just found it here. They have it now, of course." Maggie stood there stiffly for a long moment, wanting to fight everything she felt but trying not to. It came at her in waves, the stench of the blood, the warm stickiness of it that clotted and chilled with the icy wind touching it, and the pain, all the degrees of it, sharp jolts and dull aches and the swelling agony that was as much emotional as physical, and the intermittent flashes of darkness that lasted seconds now. Horrible darkness filled with terror and panic and loss. Such loss. She had forgotten her companions and started when John grasped her arm. She was coughing. When had she started coughing? "Maggie?
I have to get out of..."
She jerked her arm free of his grasp and lurched toward the door, almost stumbling. John started after her, but Quentin caught his arm to stop him.
"Jesus,"
the other man murmured softly. Staring at him in the dim light, John was surprised to see something that looked like awe on his friend's mobile face.
"What?"
he demanded.
"What is it? What was wrong with Maggie?"
"Wrong? I don't know if I'd call it wrong." Quentin drew a deep breath. "But I don't envy your Maggie, I'll tell you that." John didn't question the possessive. "Why?" "It explains a lot," Quentin mused. "How she's able to establish such a strong bond with victims. How she's able to so accurately draw what they see. Christ, no wonder it looks like magic to those around her."
"She's psychic?"
"It's not quite that simple, John. There's psychic, and then there's gifted, or cursed. Did you see her face just now? She was in agony, actual physical pain.
Why? What was hurting her?"
"He had hurt her, the rapist. He attacked her, raped and beat her, took her eyes, and left her here to suffer." Quentin shook his head.
"John, that's what Maggie was feeling. She was feeling everything Hollis Templeton felt in this room more than 3 weeks ago."
Chapter 5. Jennifer Seaton was a good cop, but even more, she was an intuitive cop who had learned to trust her hunches. So while Scott worked the phones attempting to track down those missing files, she got on her computer, connected to the Washington State Library System database, and conducted a different kind of search. She hit possible pay dirt before Scott did, but since it was very late on a Saturday afternoon, it took her another half hour just to track down a library still open for business.
"I understand the request, detective," the head librarian said, the confusion in her voice belying the words. "But we're locking the doors in 10 minutes and..."
"Police emergency," Jennifer said,
ruthlessly misusing her authority. If you'll hold them for me until I get there, I'd appreciate it. I'm leaving now. As she hung up the phone and rose to her feet, Scott said sourly, "Oh, yeah, leave me with this, why don't you?" "Any luck?" she asked, pausing by his desk and digging into her pocket for another cinnamon-flavored toothpick. "All I've got so far is a growing list of stations with old files stored in their basements. Nobody really knows what they've got, and nobody's volunteering to go down and check, especially on a cold Saturday afternoon. And I can't say that I blame them." He raked fingers through his hair and peered up at her. "Calling it a day?" "No, I'll be back in about an hour. I may have found a shortcut for us, or at least another source we can use. Well, bring me back a snack, will you? I missed lunch, and there's nothing here but stale sandwiches and some really stale donuts." Jennifer nodded. "I'll see what I can do. Where's Andy?" "Beats me. He was at his desk a minute ago."
"If he gets back before I do, ask him not to leave for the night until he talks to me, okay?"
"Sure." Jennifer left the station and made her way to the side lot where her car was parked. The street lights had come on, even though twilight made it easy to see, and she paused beside her car to look around. Uneasy, for no reason she could explain to herself. Being intuitive didn't make her overly imaginative, so she was surprised to realize that she definitely had the creeps. It was a sudden sensation, a chill that crawled slowly over her body and raised the hair on the nape of her neck. What her mom had sometimes referred to as somebody walking over my grave. It wasn't a commonplace feeling, and Jennifer had learned to pay attention and be wary, because she had come to realize that it invariably meant her subconscious had noted something important and or dangerous that her conscious mind was as yet unaware of. A cop's instincts, Scott called it. So what was it? The scene she studied was perfectly normal. A few cops moving in and out of the building, a couple of civilians walking briskly past on the sidewalk. Not much else. A slight wind stirred the nearby trees, their bare limbs scratching against one another while the last dead leaves clinging to them rattled dryly. Jennifer shivered and zipped her jacket all the way. "You're getting jumpy, Seaton," she muttered to herself, as if she could possibly be in danger here in the parking lot of the police station. It was absurd. But she couldn't help looking back over her shoulder as she unlocked her car, and she was careful to check the back seat thoroughly before she got in. There was nobody there, of course. But as she put the key into the ignition, Jennifer saw a folded piece of paper lying on the dashboard. Something that definitely hadn't been there when she had returned alone from lunch and locked the car up. She was wearing gloves, as usual, this time of year, so didn't hesitate to carefully unfold it. Block printed on the paper, in a faint and rather unsteady hand, were two numbers. Dates? 1894. 1934. Jennifer sat staring at the paper for a long time, her mind working. The 1934 date, always assuming it was a date, of course, corresponded with the date of the murders in their incomplete files. And that couldn't be a coincidence. Could it? Was the earlier date another year during which other similar crimes had taken place? Was their brutal rapist copying crimes from long ago, choosing his victims to closely match doomed women some other monster had attacked and left for dead, adding only his own personal twist of blinding them? If he was, why? What twisted motivation compelled him to at least partially recreate old unsolved crimes? Because they were unsolved? Because he believed he, too, could commit his crimes and walk away undiscovered? Could it be so simple? That possibility was unsettling enough. What really disturbed Jennifer was the certainty that someone had placed this note inside her locked car while it had been parked mere yards away from the police station. Someone who seemingly knew a lot more about this series of brutal rapes than the police had yet discovered. Who? And was this note an effort to help the police? Or was it a direct and mocking challenge from an animal more hunter than hunted?
She's gone, John said as he rejoined Quentin in the chill, empty room at the top of the stairs. Told you she would be. Quentin moved slowly around the room, his flashlight pointed at the floor. Most of his attention seemed focused on what he was doing, but his voice was matter of fact. Fight or flight? She couldn't fight, so she ran. I imagine she has a place she feels safe and reasonably secure. Home, probably. She'll be there. She'll need to be there, at least for a while. John frowned as he watched his friend. The room still wasn't quite dark, and he could see Quentin fairly well. Is that why you stopped me when I would have gone after her? Because she needed to get somewhere she felt safe? And because I knew you'd push her. What are you talking about? Push her how? Push her to tell you whatever information she might have gained in this room. Information that could help us find answers. You're convinced she can help us find those answers, and your tendency will be to press forward without any loss of time, just the way you would in business. And I'm telling you, that's the wrong tactic with Maggie. Like it or not, you're going to have to be very careful with her. She'll help us in her own time and her own fashion, and that's the way it's going to be. Why? Because she's gifted? Pretty much, yeah. John, living with this sort of thing, most of us develop defense mechanisms to cope. If we have understanding, or at least sympathetic family and friends, the defenses tend to be simple ones. But if we feel too alone, too isolated and different from those around us, especially for most of a lifetime, then the defenses can be major and complex. I'd guess your Maggie belongs in the latter group. Isolated? She's surrounded by people who admire what she does, John objected. Not one of the cops I talked to showed anything but respect and gratitude toward her. Hell, it was almost awe. I'm sure they are grateful, and I'm sure they respect her for her ability to help them catch bad guys. But that awe you were picking up on can be read another way. Fear. You can bet most of those cops don't understand how she does the things she does. And when there's no understanding, there's often fear, especially if something that looks like magic. You can also bet that Maggie knows exactly how they feel. It doesn't seem to bother her, John said. At the station, she was very sure of herself, not at all hesitant. She would be. There. My guess is that while she's probably strongly emphatic with people and able to bond with them fairly easily when she wants to, where she really connects is at a scene of violence, like this one. Quentin hunkered down for a moment to more closely examine the area of floor where a mattress had lain. How is that possible? Well, one theory is that thoughts and emotions contain an actual electrical signature, a form of energy that may linger in objects, in an area, especially if what was experienced in that area is particularly intense or violent. If you think about it, it'd explain a lot of the so-called ghostly sightings of things like battles and soldiers. Hell, there are places in Europe where some people swear ancient Roman soldiers still march. You don't believe in ghosts? If you mean, do I believe the dead have an existence beyond the flesh? Yes, I do. But I'm also convinced that what most people believe are ghosts are actually those electrical signatures I'm talking about. Violent things happened in some places, and some of those places, for reasons we don't yet understand, retain that energy. It wouldn't be visible to most people, because people tend to use their senses in only the simplest and most limited way. But some people would be sensitive to it, able to feel and possibly interpret the energy. As a rough comparison, think about static buildup on a cold, dry day. It isn't apparent until you touch something and are able to discharge the energy. Are you saying Maggie's a conduit? More or less. If electrical energy can permeate objects, then it's reasonable to assume that energy would remain for at least a while, until it could dissipate naturally,
or could be discharged through some kind of contact. You make it sound like a logical equation. Quentin straightened and absently flexed cramped muscles. In a way it is. Stop thinking of it as something magical or unnatural. Take what you know is scientific and push it a little further. Extend it to the next logical step. On the most basic level, our thoughts are nothing more than electrical energy interpreted by the brain. True? True. Okay, then it's perfectly reasonable to suppose that just as there are incredibly gifted musicians and scientists, people who seem born with amazing knowledge and abilities, some people could also be born with an unusual sensitivity to the kind of energy we're talking about. Just another talent or ability, perfectly human, even if rare. Where you look at this room and see dirt and stains and peeling wallpaper, people especially sensitive to the electrical energy of thoughts and emotions might see a lot more. John shook his head. Even assuming I can accept that, it still doesn't explain Maggie and what she seemed to be going through. You seriously expect me to believe that she has the ability to feel, physically experience, what happened to another person here in this room weeks ago? You saw the same thing I did, Quentin reminded him. Yeah, but you didn't believe it. I believe she's sensitive enough to have imagined what Hollis Templeton must have gone through here in this room, but to say she actually physically felt it, no, I don't believe that. I can't believe it, Quentin. Which is another reason I told you not to go after her. Quentin completed his examination of the room and returned to John. One of the hardest things to deal with when you know you can do something beyond the abilities of most other people is the disbelief and often fear of those around you. Nobody quite calls you a liar, but the doubt is easy to see and feel, especially when you can't really prove what you can do. She can't prove to you that she's an empath any more than I can prove to you I know some future events before they happen, even though I keep trying. Quentin studied his friend with a faint smile. We've laughed and joked about it for nearly 20 years, and in all that time, you've ascribed my ability to tell you what's going to happen before it happens to luck, to intuition, to inspired guesswork, or a logical sequence of events. To everything except what it is. Precognition. Clairvoyance. Knowledge before the fact. You've been right more than you've been wrong, John admitted. Thank you, Quentin said dryly. But how is it possible to know something before it happens? Explain that by taking what we know to be scientific and extending it to the next logical level. I can't. The truth is, I have no idea how I'm able to do it. If I understood it, I could probably control it. I could say to myself, Quentin, old buddy, how will the stock market look by, say, the end of the year? What lottery numbers are going to come up winners? Which one of the dot-com companies is really worth an investment? Who'll win the Super Bowl? He shrugged. But it doesn't work like that. I wish it did. But it doesn't. Which is why you can't tell me if the police are going to catch this rapist. Which is why. I only know what my wayward mind chooses to tell me, and that isn't something I've been told. So far, at least. Sometimes, once I've got involved in a situation, I've been able to pick up facts related to the future of that situation. But my control could best be described as erratic as hell. That's not much help. Tell me about it. You know, my boss says that if a psychic is ever born who can totally control his or her abilities, the whole world will change. He's probably right. He usually is, damn it. John stirred slightly. And speaking of Bishop, how long before he shows up here with blood in his eye? Never, I hope. Quentin sighed. Realistically, I figure I've got maybe 48 hours or so until the case he's on breaks, or he has a spare minute or two to realize I should be back at Quantico by now.
I was going to ask Kendra to run interference for me, but I figured we'd need her here. She's a crackerjack profiler and researcher, as well as an adept, and we may well need all her abilities.
She's at the hotel?
Yeah, on the computer, tapping into every database we thought might be helpful. And I suggest we go back there. This place is giving me the creeps.
Professionally? Or psychically?
Both. Not being empathic, all I get is a sense that the bastard picked his dumping place very carefully. But I don't know why. The cop in me sees the signs that other cops went over this area with a fine-tooth comb. I won't find anything they missed. You have the forensics report?
A copy, yeah.
By mutual consent, both men turned and began making their way out of the abandoned building. I have no way of knowing, of course, how complete it is, but I'm betting Drummond has given orders to hold back on at least some information. Probably. It's standard procedure to keep some facts within the investigating unit, to weed out copycats and more quickly zero in on similar crimes, if nothing else. Maybe. But I figure this is personal. Don't get paranoid. It isn't that. I've weighed enough competitors across boardroom tables to know when someone is out to beat me. Drummond wants his people to find this bastard, and he wants it bad. He isn't above keeping some information out of my hands just to make sure I'm handicapped. His political aspirations? Partly. And he's the competitive sort by nature. Well, Quentin said, we can work around that. Hopefully. You do realize we're going to have to be very, very careful not to do anything to impede the official investigation. I realize that. And that your Maggie is going to have to walk a very fine line while she works to help both us and the police. After what happened here, I'm not at all sure she'll be willing to help us, John said. Willing, Quentin said, has little to do with it. Unless I miss my guess, Maggie Barnes feels she has to help us. She simply doesn't have a choice.
I don't like it, Andy said. He stared down at the scrap of paper now sealed in a clear plastic evidence envelope, feeling as grim as he looked. Jen, you're sure this wasn't in your car when you got back from lunch today?
Positive. So somebody put it in there while my car, my locked car, was parked in a police lot. Lousy security around here, Andy. He looked across his desk at Jennifer, not misled by the flippant tone, and he didn't blame her for being shaken. He was pretty damned unnerved himself. Assuming this is useful information and not just a couple of random numbers, and assuming it's even connected to this particular case, I suppose somebody might have been trying to help us. Or it could have been some enterprising member of the press, maybe trying to get a reaction out of us, he speculated. It's at least conceivable that one of them might have stumbled onto the 1934 murders. Scott, sitting across from Jennifer in Andy's other visitor's chair, said reluctantly, "Isn't that a bit of a stretch? I mean, even supposing a reporter dug up the similar murders, why tell us, and anonymously? Why not just run with the story?"
"Yeah, it's a stretch," Andy admitted. "The truth is, I can't think of a reason why anybody'd do this. Except for our perp, that is."
Having given the matter a lot of thought, Jennifer shook her head. "I don't see that. He's gone to a hell of a lot of trouble to hide from us. Why step out into the open and do this? If he wanted to taunt us, I figured he'd do it another way. Maybe leave something on the victim or change his M.O. suddenly. But notes left in a cop's car? No, I don't think it's him."
"Then who?" Scott demanded. "You and I stumbled into this just tossing around ideas because we were frustrated there wasn't more we could do. How likely is it that somebody else took the same turns and reached the same possibility?"
"Not very," she admitted. "Besides which, if this note was intended to be helpful, then why give it to us anonymously and make damn sure there were no prints on it? Why not come forward and explain themselves?" Slowly, Andy said,
unless whoever it is knows there's a connection because he, or she, knows or suspects who the rapist is. It wouldn't be the first time a family member or a suspicious wife or girlfriend knew just enough to worry about it, but was too afraid or ashamed of their suspicions to come forward openly. A good possibility. But why the hell did they have to pick my car? And how'd they unlock and then relock the doors without leaving signs, damn it? Maybe it was a locksmith, Scott offered, only half joking. Andy shrugged. Hell, maybe it was just somebody who knows cars well enough to be able to get into yours, Jen. Or had an electronic key that worked. In these days of glorified electronics, it's getting easier rather than harder to jack cars, so why not? Anyway, until we find out who left the note, there's no way of knowing. I really hate not knowing, Jennifer said gloomily. Andy picked up the scrap of paper and studied it more closely. Do any of those books of yours have murders listed for 1894? Nothing like what we have here. Or at least I don't think so. I might be able to find other books, but when I found these, they seemed to be all the ones available on local unsolved crimes. That means we'll have to depend on our own police files, and we'll have to look all the way back to 1894. Scott groaned. Shit. I can already tell you that either we do the legwork ourselves, going into the basements and storage rooms of the other buildings to dig into the files, or else somebody's going to have to make it a priority request to get us some more willing hands. Andy, I've been pretty cagey about asking so far. I haven't wanted to say what case it is. Not when all this is so... iffy, Jennifer supplied dryly. Weird, Scott corrected. Call a spade a spade. Anyway, without something more solid to go on, I didn't really want to tell file clerks in the other divisions why I was interested in the old files. And I sure as hell wouldn't want to talk to the detectives about it, at least not until we're sure there's a connection. Not even then, Andy ordered, after only a moment's thought. We keep this among ourselves for the time being. If our guy is a copycat, and we've managed to find his playbook, I sure as hell don't want to show our hand. The last thing we need is anybody outside the team discovering what we've found and broadcasting the info. That means we do the legwork. Jennifer didn't appear to be nearly as daunted as Scott was. Her eyes were very bright, and she was smiling a little. We'll need some kind of excuse, Andy, if we don't want the other cops to start wondering what we're up to. I mean, how often do we need to dig up files over 100 years old? Andy pursed his lips as he considered that, his mind turning over various possibilities. Then he smiled. I've got it. Everybody knows Drummond is ambitious as hell and always coming up with this theory or that plan to improve police efficiency, so the political powers that be will take notice. So we tell anybody who asks that he's got a new bee in his bonnet and has us hunting down records of past crimes in order to do a comparative study. As long as it's one of you asking and not me, I don't see anybody tying it to a current investigation, and most especially not this one. Because we're glorified gophers, Scott said, sighing. No, Andy corrected. Because I've had TV cameras shoved in my face as the lead detective on this investigation. The rest of our team is thankfully invisible to the public, and to most cops outside this division. Just keep your requests casual, and try to sound completely bored with the whole thing. Are you going to tell Drummond about this? Jennifer asked. Not yet. Not unless and until we have some very solid connections between past victims and present ones. Voicing a reluctant thought, Jennifer said, "What if we do all this work and still end up with information that doesn't help us stop this creep? Knowing how many women he plans to attack won't help us identify possible victims before he gets them. Records this old, we're lucky to get sketches and reasonably accurate descriptions of the victims, and we can only connect those crimes he's already committed."
So what good will it do us to find all the files? Scott echoed. It might do us a lot of good, Andy said.
Think about it. If this bastard is copying past crimes, he has to have a source for his information. And if we're lucky, it'll either be books like those Jen found, or our files. Either way, we may be able to find something. A name on a library card or notation by a police file clerk that a certain file was checked out for research purposes by whoever. Anything that might point us in his direction. Would he have been that careless? Jennifer wondered. Andy smiled. Careless? What possible fact or lead would have led us to look 100 years into the past for clues? The very idea is absurd. Across town in his studio, Beau Rafferty worked on the painting that was his latest commission, using an exceptionally fine brush to get the most painstaking detail exactly right. He was a perfectionist, always had been. And he had an ever-present sense of his surroundings, a built-in radar that told him whenever someone was near, even when they didn't make a sound opening his front door or moving through his house to the studio. One of these days, I'll have to start locking that door, he said without turning around.
That might be a good idea. These are dangerous times.
The times are always dangerous. People never change. Beau glanced back over his shoulder at the visitor. Is that why you're here?
Don't you know?
Beau returned his attention to the painting and very carefully shadowed a character line in the lovely face. No, I didn't see you. I probably should have, I guess. You're usually around when bad things start happening.
Bad things have been happening here for quite a while.
Yes.
So what brings you now?
Maggie?
Would that surprise you?
No, not really. You were back east when it started, weren't you?
Yes.
They never put it together when it started.
Beau shook his head.
Not so surprising, I suppose. He's always more lucky than he is careful. And he's very careful.
He doesn't want them to see him.
Beau turned at last from the painting, frowning as he began to clean his brushes. But Maggie will see him. Sooner or later. She's determined to. The only question is, will she see him before he sees her?
I know.
I want to help her.
I know you do, but you can't.
I could at least tell her what to watch out for, who to trust.
No, you can't do that, and you know it. Free will. You've already told her too much.
Beau put his brushes away and studied his visitor wryly.
I haven't told her about you. I appreciate that.
Do you? I wonder.
Beau shook his head. Never mind. I don't think I want to know, after all.
Is there a particular reason you came to see me today?
Yes. I wanted to talk to you about Christina Walsh and why she died.
Chapter 6. Monday, November 5th. Gazing around the large, spacious room, Quentin said, "There are hotel rooms, and then there are hotel rooms." Without looking up from her laptop, Kendra said,
"That's the third time you've said something like that. Keep it up, and John will think the FBI makes its agents stay in backstreet dives crawling with roaches and rats."
I never said it was that bad.
Quentin went into the kitchenette to pour himself a fresh cup of coffee, then came back into the parlor.
But you must admit, this is much, much better than our usual digs.
Kendra did look up then, rather absently glancing around the spacious, airy parlor of their two-bedroom suite. It was a room geared to business functions, with half the space taken up by a generous desk containing every modern technological amenity, including a multi-line phone, fax machine, and a computer supplied by the hotel, and a conference table that seated 8. On the other side of the room,
A sitting area grouped around a large television promised relaxation, conversation, or entertainment. It was a luxurious space in the sense of true luxury. Nothing ornate or gilded, but beautiful, well-made, and comfortable furnishings and fixtures, and muted but tasteful decorating. Not exactly surprising for the best hotel in the city. She smiled slightly as she watched Quentin contemplate with satisfaction the oil painting hanging over the desk, but said mildly, "With your taste for luxury, I don't know why on earth you ever joined the Bureau." "I don't have a taste for luxury. I just enjoy being in a room that isn't a carbon copy of every other room in the place." Pretending, as always, that she hadn't noticed him neatly evade the implied question about his past, Kendra said, "Well, while you're enjoying that, could you please hand me the forensics file? Once I get the last of that fed into our personal investigation database here, we'll have everything the police say they have." "You're as paranoid as John is," he told her, taking a file from the stack on the desk and handing it across the conference table to her. "I resent that," John said, coming out of Quentin's bedroom, closing up his cell phone. His leather jacket was hanging over a chair in the sitting room, and he slid the phone into a pocket before joining them at the conference table. "You should never resent the truth," Quentin said. "Did you get a hold of Maggie?" "I got her voicemail. Asked her to drop by here in the next couple of hours, if possible, or to meet me at the station at 4. John gave Quentin a wry look. "I was very polite and low-key. No pressure, no demands, just a pleasant request." Seriously, Quentin said, "There will come a time for demands, John. Believe me." "What do you mean?" It was Kendra who answered, her gaze remaining on the files, whose information she was feeding into the laptop's database. Her fingers flew, even as she spoke. "In this sort of investigation, the emotions of everyone involved tend to grow more powerful and erratic as time goes on, naturally. Not just for the victims, but for the investigators as well. It'll be hard on all of us, but particularly on an empath. At some point, Maggie's natural instincts for self-preservation will demand that she distance herself from all the pain around her." "And that's when we make demands?" John asked, watching Kendra in unconscious fascination. It was his first encounter with Quentin's usual partner, and so far he wasn't having much luck in figuring her out. A quiet, contained woman with rich brown hair and soft brown eyes, she was pretty without being in any way extraordinary, except that she obviously was. "That's when we'll have to. Always assuming she's a help in the investigation and not a drawback." "Why would she be a drawback?" "Powerful emotions tend to cloud the mind and affect judgment, among other things. Worse for an empath, naturally. Maybe she's learned to handle that, or maybe not. If not, feeling her own and everyone else's pain could drive her to do things she wouldn't ordinarily do. For instance, she could get careless with her actions, or incautious in sharing information, get obsessed with a particular line of investigation to the exclusion of all else, or, conversely, have increasing difficulty in even remembering things from one day to the next. She could strike out at those around her." Quentin murmured, "That would be us." Kendra nodded, but added, "She could also feel driven to resolve the situation as quickly as possible, whatever the cost to herself." "You said her instincts for self-preservation would protect her," John objected. "Eventually, yes. But from all we've been able to find out, Maggie's been doing this for some years, which means she has to be strongly motivated to see it through. But this is quite probably the worst investigation she's been involved in, given the depth and scale of the sheer human suffering. Rape is bad enough for any woman to just have to imagine. Feeling that physical and emotional trauma, even at second hand, has got to be sheer hell. When you hurt badly enough, you'll do almost anything to stop the pain as quickly as possible." "She could do that by walking away." "Could she?" Kendra glanced up, her fingers pausing only an instant, then continued with her work and continued speaking calmly. Whether or not you believe she's an empath, John, you can't deny that for anyone to deliberately expose themselves on a regular basis to the worst pain and trauma experienced by other people argues an incredible amount of resolution and dedication. She's driven to do this out of some deeply felt motivation, and whatever it is, it won't allow her to just walk away.
So she'll stick it out as long as she can bear it, Quentin said, deliberately opening herself up to pain and emotions none of us would choose to feel, if we had a choice. Fighting herself and her own instincts harder than she'll ever have to fight anyone or anything else.
In other words, she's a loaded gun, John said. More like nitroglycerin in a paper cup. John sighed.
But she can help us.
Quentin nodded.
Oh, yeah. You were right about that. She can help us. She might even be able to help herself by the time this is over. But the duration is apt to be painful for everyone concerned.
I buried my sister a few months ago, John said steadily. More painful than that? Quentin hesitated, traded a quick glance with Kendra, then said,
Could be, John. I know that's hard for you to believe, but the truth is that when new pain follows old pain, the weight of the whole tends to be a hell of a lot heavier than any individual wound. Her eyes once again on the forensics file, Kendra said, 4 victims so far, and the rapist has left us virtually no hard evidence to consider. Nothing even remotely objective for us to concentrate on. That means our investigation is going to have to focus on the people involved. Victims, their backgrounds, friends and families, people in pain all around us. Frightened, angry, grieving, hurting people. John looked from one to the other of them with a frown.
Are you two trying to persuade me to leave Maggie out of this?
We never attempt the impossible, Quentin said. Almost never, Kendra corrected. Quentin considered that. Then shrugged and said to John, Anyway, what we're trying to do is warn you that things are likely to get a lot worse before they get better. Even for you.
How could things get worse?
Wincing, Quentin replied,
Never, never ask that question. Things can always get worse, and usually do. We've got a vicious madman roaming around out there, and he hasn't exactly left us a trail of breadcrumbs to follow in order to stop him. We have 4 victims so far, and no sign whatsoever that there won't be more. We don't know how he's choosing said victims, who appear to have virtually nothing in common except that they're female and white, which gives us about half the population of a major city to worry about. We have a police lieutenant with political aspirations in charge of a police department that seems to have just about reached the limits of its resources. We have a frightened city, an increasingly militant press, and we have to walk on eggshells while trying to investigate this because we're not supposed to be involved. Quentin drew a breath, traded another glance with Kendra, then finished.
How could things get worse?
Jesus, John, how could they not?
All right. Point taken.
Quentin didn't press it. When Kendra finishes our database, we'll run a comparison with everything the Bureau has on unsolved aggravated rape cases, even though most such seemingly isolated crimes aren't technically FBI territory. We've begun in recent years keeping track of as many as possible simply because sexual predators tend to grow more and more violent the longer they remain at large. And they usually have a history, if we can find it and track it.
What do you mean?
He's been active here in Seattle for about 6 months, as near as the police can estimate. But his ritual is too well established for him to be that new at it.
I thought you weren't a profiler.
I'm not the best at it, but I work with a few of the best, and I've picked up a thing or two. Kendra agrees with me on this. Our guy is no rookie.
So he's been active somewhere else?
Probably.
Wouldn't the police have checked for that? Quentin nodded. Sure. According to the reports, they did. But in checking NCIC and VICAP and various other sources, it looks like they only listed the most obvious similarities between these attacks. That he blinds and maims his victims, never speaks to them, dumps them somewhere else in a fairly isolated place when he's finished with them. Not nearly enough specifics and similarities to provide for a thorough search of all the available files, in our experience. What other similarities are there? It was Kendra who replied. He goes to extraordinary lengths to make certain these women can never identify him, yet it's clear he watches them for at least a period of time before he grabs them. He has very specific reasons for taking the women he takes, and it has nothing to do with how easily he can get his hands on them. He's varied his methods of blinding, becoming arguably more adept and skilled at it, which indicates it's a fairly recent part of his ritual. He may well have begun by simply blindfolding his victims or knocking them unconscious before raping them, a possibility that must be noted. The fact that he blinds them now could be a natural evolution and escalation of his ritual, or it could be because at least one victim in his past saw him and was able to identify him. After a moment, John said, "You mean this bastard might have been caught at some point? Jailed?" "Possibly." "And what, escaped?" "Maybe. Or maybe served his time. I'm estimating he's between 30 and 40 now, so he certainly could have served time in prison at some point." "Do you believe he did?" Kendra paused in her typing long enough to turn to a new page in the report she was studying, then replied, "No. Somehow I don't think he's seen the inside of a jail. I think he moves around, changing location after some specific period of time or specific event or point of transition in his ritual." "So," Quentin said, "we'll run all the information and educated guesswork and skilled speculation we can muster and compare it to the bureau files drawn from police departments all over the country. If we're very lucky, we just might find enough to be able to build a history on this bastard. And with a history we can study, there's a better chance of figuring him out, of knowing where and how to look for him." Kendra said, "Once the database is set up, it'll probably take a day or two to run the comparison, at least with the information we've got, and that may only give us a long list of possibles we'll have to narrow down. In the meantime, we need more details and history on the victims than the police files have provided, so I'd say gathering that will be the next step." John looked at Quentin. "How does she do that? Type and talk at the same time?" "Her uniquely flexible mind," Quentin murmured. "It's a little scary," John noted. "Yeah, I think she does it just to unnerve me." Kendra smiled, but didn't look up from the file. "It would also probably be wise to check in with the police and find out if they have anything new." "That's why I asked Maggie to meet me at the station," John said. "Not that I expect them to have anything new, but Andy would sure as hell start to wonder if I didn't keep turning up there to ask every day or two." He was looking at Kendra, but when she stopped typing suddenly and looked at Quentin, he followed her gaze and felt an odd little chill. Quentin didn't seem to be looking at anything in particular, except perhaps something only he could see. His eyes were unfocused, yet curiously fixed, unblinking, and he was very, very still. "Quentin?" Kendra's voice was quiet. "What is it?" He didn't answer immediately. It was a full minute of silence before he stirred and looked at them, saw them. His expression hadn't changed, but there was something bleak in the depths of his eyes. Slowly, he said, "The police will have something new, John. Any minute now." Hollis knew that Maggie was relaxed. She could hear that in the other woman's casual tone. It was an interesting voice, oddly compelling for something so soft and pleasant, and as deceptively benign as the surface calm of a deep pool.
But what lay beneath the surface?
Something always did. We can talk about anything you like, she was saying. Just like when I came back yesterday. Pick a topic. The weather, sports, cabbages and kings.
Hollis smiled.
My favorite quote was always the one about believing 6 impossible things before breakfast. That always seemed like a good attitude to have.
I know what you mean. The way the world is these days, it's almost incomprehensible how anyone could have a closed mind. It seems like most every day there's a story in the news about one of our certainties being turned on its ear.
Maybe that's what it means to be human, Hollis offered, forever questioning our certainties.
Maybe, Maggie agreed. It's as good a definition as any other, I guess.
She paused, then said, Only a few more days until the bandages come off. How do you feel about that?
You sound like the hospital shrink, Hollis noted, neatly avoiding an answer.
Sorry. Occupational hazard, I suppose. I spend so much time asking people how they feel about one thing or another. But I am curious. If the operation was successful, and you can see again, do you think that will help you to get past this and move on with your life?
Hollis didn't really want to answer, but heard herself answering anyway.
In some ways, sure. If I can see, he won't have destroyed everything. I'd still have my art, and still in the same way, so that'd probably help. Give me something to concentrate on.
But your art is going to be different no matter what, Maggie said. Nobody experiences violence without coming out of it fundamentally changed.
You mean the dreams?
Hollis asked the question jerkily.
Yes.
Maggie's voice remained quiet, easy, as if nothing she said was at all unusual.
Your dreams have become more violent and far more vivid, with nightmares common. You wake up often in the night, suddenly, even without nightmares. Most of your senses have become sharper, and you'll be quicker to react to them. And it'll be a long time, if ever, before you feel completely safe again.
You're more blunt about it than the shrink was.
I don't see any reason to soft-pedal it. You're an intelligent woman, and you've had plenty of time to think these last weeks, to wonder, to ask yourself what is and will be different now.
Your art will be. I don't have to know what you drew or painted before to be certain of that.
Yeah, I know.
Hollis gripped the arms of the chair, her fingers clenching and unclenching restlessly.
But how will it be different?
There's no way to be sure until you find out for yourself. I'd guess that if you paint, you'll discover a tendency towards starker images, more vivid colors. You may choose subjects you avoided before, or even fixate on 1 or 2 images to the exclusion of most others.
Images like the scalpel he used to take my eyes?
Maybe. Or some other image that represents violence or loss to you. It might have no connection at all to what happened to you, at least to all appearances. But it will be connected. And you'll know how, or we'll have to figure it out. The images won't leave you alone until you deal with them.
Maggie's voice remained matter-of-fact, but wasn't without compassion or understanding. Hollis drew a shaky breath.
My mind was always preoccupied with images before this. But how will there be images, visible images, from this? What happened to me was all darkness. I never saw anything at all.
Your other senses will fill in the blanks. What you heard and felt, what you smelled, what you touched, and what touched you.
Evil touched me. How will I paint that?
I don't know. But you'll know. Eventually, you'll know. And you'll have to paint it, or somehow give it form. That's what artists do.
Is that what you do? Give evil form?
I suppose I do. Or at least try to give it a face.
Hollis half laughed under her breath. You know what's most ironic about all this? I came out here for a whole new start. I inherited enough money to be able to quit my crass commercial art job and spend a few years finding out if I had enough talent to be a real artist. And I'd barely got my studio set up when this happened. Fate just loves to kick us in the ass.
Yeah, I've noticed.
Maggie paused, then added, I suppose it's useless to ask you if you remember anybody watching you before the attack, following you.
I don't remember anything out of the ordinary. So if he was watching me, I never saw him. Which is a very, very creepy thought.
Why did he... Do you know why he picked me?
The police haven't found a helpful common denominator among the victims. Different physical appearances, different jobs and lifestyles, a fairly wide range of ages. Though he does seem to lean toward women in their 20s. It was probably nothing you did, Hollis, and it certainly wasn't your fault. You just fit whatever requirements he's put together in his twisted mind.
Do you think he'll do it again? Attack another woman?
Yes.
The immediate, calm answer made Hollis hesitate, but only for a moment. Until he stopped.
Yes. Of course.
But why? Why is he doing this?
It was Maggie's turn to hesitate, but then she replied slowly, I'm sure a psychologist or a profiler could develop all sorts of motivations, and I'm sure they'd be right. There are always reasons, at least explainable, if not understandable, even for monsters.
But there's only one real reason, isn't there? One real motivation behind his acts.
Yes, there's always a single driving motivation behind a predator like this one. Hollis tilted her head, listening to that voice, the steady calm that was so deceptive. She wondered what it was she could almost hear moving about in the unseen depths beneath Maggie's tranquility. Something... cold. No, not really cold. Chilled. Something dark and chilled.
Fear? Knowledge? Understanding?
For some reason, Hollis was unwilling to ask aloud. Maybe because she didn't know Maggie well. Maybe because she was half convinced she was imagining way too much in the darkness behind her bandages. Or maybe just because she was afraid of the answer. She forced herself to concentrate on the subject of a monster's motivation.
What is it? Why does he do this to us, Maggie?
Because he wants to. Because he likes it.
Hollis drew a breath. Yes, I felt that. The way he touched me. As if the very texture of my skin intrigued him somehow. The way he smelled me.
He enjoyed your scent?
Must have. Or wanted to remember it later. He kept sniffing. I'd feel his breath on my skin, then hear him sniff. My arm, my throat, breasts, all over. I'd stopped begging by then.
Hollis heard her own voice as though it belonged to someone else, the words coming faster and faster, almost spilling out of her.
I was tied up, unable to move. When I'd come to the first time, it was to realize he'd taken my eyes. I struggled, then fought him, cursed him, but it was no use. No matter how loud I screamed or how hard I struggled, it didn't seem to affect him at all. He did what he wanted to do, raped me. And after that, after I'd stopped screaming and cursing, he beat me, almost methodically. It seemed to take all my will to deal with the pain without screaming. I didn't want him to hear me scream from the pain. Didn't want him to have that satisfaction.
so I didn't make a sound, just concentrated on listening to him.
What else did you hear, Hollis?
Him? Breathing? He was very quiet, but once or twice I heard him humming to himself. Not a tune I recognized, although there was something familiar about it. Not even a tune, really, just humming, and... And? There was something else, but... I can't remember. I know I heard another sound, a sound that bothered me somehow, because I recognized it, or thought I should have. Something. But I don't remember it now. Hollis knew Maggie leaned toward her and didn't start when a cool hand covered one of hers. You'll remember when you can, Hollis. I remember everything else. I remember every goddamn thing he did to me. I remember the way his breath smelled in my face like spearmint chewing gum. The way he smelled of ivory soap. The way his skin felt against mine, hot and slick with the sweat. The way he grunted in the back of his throat while he raped me. I remember everything. Except that. Why not that?
There's a reason. There's always a reason.
You mean my mind doesn't want me to remember? But why that? All the horrible things he did to me. And I can't remember a sound? Just a sound? Why?
I don't know. But we'll figure it out. I promise you, Hollis. We'll figure it out.
Maggie drew a little breath, and Hollis thought she heard a catch in the sound, but the other woman's voice was steady when she said,
Can you start from the beginning? Can you tell me everything that happened from the moment he grabbed you?
Yes, Hollis said. Her hand turned and gripped Maggie's tightly. I think I can now. Hollis Templeton's room was around a corner and near the end of an unusually quiet corridor on a quiet floor of the hospital. Her doctors felt she would be better off not disturbed by the hustle and bustle common in most of the building. So when John got off the elevator and passed the silent waiting room, he found himself half-consciously walking more quietly down the deserted hallway so as not to intrude upon the peaceful atmosphere. He turned the corner, having seen no one, and stopped abruptly when he did see someone. Maggie. She was outside Hollis's room, leaning back against the wall beside the closed door. She was hugging her sketch pad with both arms, her head bent, long hair falling forward to mostly hide her pale face. But even from this distance, John could see her shoulders shaking and hear the muffled but wrenching sobs. Before she could see or sense him there, John stepped silently back around the corner and retreated to the doorway of the waiting room, more shaken than he wanted to admit to himself. Magic. No, it wasn't magic, what she did. Whether her ability was paranormal, as Quentin insisted, or merely an overdeveloped sensitivity to the feelings of others, the undeniable fact was that Maggie suffered right along with the victims of violence she tried to help. He wondered if he had the right to ask her to put herself through that, if anyone did. And not for the first time, he wondered why she did it. He had considered having her background investigated, certainly something he could have done, but it wasn't his habit to acquire information about people that way. Especially people he wanted to work with. Digging into somebody's past without so much as a by your leave was hardly a good first step to induce trust and cooperation. Both Quentin and Kendra had adamantly stated that Maggie's motives had to be both powerful and deeply felt. And John could see that clearly enough. To willingly put herself through what she did, her reasons would have to be strong ones. So what were they? What could possibly drive a sensitive woman with the intelligence and artistic talent to be anything she wanted, to torture herself this way? John shoved his hands into the pockets of his jacket and waited there, leaning beside the doorway, all too aware that only Maggie could answer that question.
and nobody had to tell him it wasn't something she would willingly discuss, especially with a virtual stranger. Both the question and that reluctant answer were difficult to accept, and he thought about both, so preoccupied that he didn't hear her approach until she spoke. "What are you doing here?" Except for a faint redness around her eyes and a hint of strain in her face, there were no lingering signs of that storm of emotion John had briefly witnessed. "I called the station. Andy said you were probably here talking to Hollis Templeton. He said he'd tried to call you."
"I turned off my cell phone. I usually do during interviews."
Maggie frowned slightly.
"But I got your message. I was planning to meet you at 4.
He nodded, accepting that. "Yeah, well, it might be a good idea if we go there now."
"Why?"
He didn't want to tell her, but there was no choice. "The police think there's been another attack, Maggie. A woman was reported missing a couple of hours ago. Her husband just returned from a business trip and discovered her gone and the front door literally standing open."
Maggie was very still, staring up at him. "There's something else, isn't there? What else?"
He really didn't want to tell her.
"John, what is it?"
"She's pregnant. More than 6 months."
Hollis remained in her chair by the window, but only because she felt too drained to move. Talking about the attack, telling Maggie all the horrible, painful details, even those she hadn't dared think about, had exhausted her, but not nearly as much as she had expected it to. And her emotional state was much better than it had any right to be. She knew that. She felt peculiarly calm, almost. At peace.
"Because of her."
"Because of Maggie?"
By now it seemed almost normal to discuss things with her figment. Reassuring, even. "Yes."
"Why?"
"Just because she listened. Because she was sympathetic and understanding." "No, because she took some of your pain."
Hollis frowned.
"What do you mean?" "She took it away. Took it into herself, so that you wouldn't hurt so much."
"You don't...
surely you don't mean she actually physically absorbed what I was feeling?" "She has a unique gift. It's why I wanted you to talk to her, so you could begin to heal."
"But
she felt it? All the pain?" "Yes."
Hollis was horrified.
She wouldn't have wished that on anyone, and for Maggie to have suffered so when she was only trying to help.
"Damn it! Why didn't you warn me?"
"I couldn't warn you. Neither could she. We both knew you'd fight not to inflict such pain on another. We both knew you wouldn't tell her the things she had to know. If you had been warned, it would hurt her too."
As upset as she was, Hollis had a realization then, one she was surprised hadn't occurred to her before. "You know her, don't you? You know Maggie."
"Yes, I know Maggie. I know her very well."
Chapter 7. The forensics team is going over that house inch by inch, but so far nothing. I've got people canvassing the neighborhood, but on a busy Monday with most at work or at school, the area was all but deserted. Today, anyway.
"How long was the husband away?" John asked.
"From last Thursday. He says at a business conference on the East Coast, and I don't expect to find anything different. He arrived at SeaTac this morning, sure enough. And I bet my pension he's half out of his mind with worry, so I'm not looking at him as a suspect. He says he talked to her late last night when he called from his hotel. Records confirm he certainly called the house, and there was a lengthy conversation. So we're probably looking at about a 12-hour window during which she might have disappeared. According to friends and family, she wouldn't have run away."
Maggie tried to concentrate on what Andy was telling them,
but it wasn't easy. The interview with Hollis, productive though it might turn out to be, had drained her. The pain and anguish of the other woman, dragged out into the light of day and sanity for the first time since the attack, had been virtually an open wound. Maggie needed to recover from that. Unfortunately, she hadn't been granted the time or seclusion necessary. So she was faking it. Or trying to. The husband said you'd never know she's pregnant. One of those women who hardly shows at all right up to delivery, apparently. He knows, Maggie heard herself say. Andy frowned across his desk at her. The rapist? If she isn't showing, how could...
He's been watching her. He could have seen her doing things to prepare for a baby.
Things? John asked. Maggie didn't look at him.
Doctor visits, shopping, decorating. It's a first baby. There'd be a lot to do.
Andy said, but he might not have realized how far along she is.
Maybe not. I wouldn't bet money on it, though.
Andy grimaced and rubbed the nape of his neck. No, me either. Is this supposed to be a fun new twist for the bastard? Christ, if it turns out that Samantha Mitchell was taken by the rapist, this city is going to come apart at the seams. Maggie drew a breath and fought to keep her voice steady.
You realize she's not likely to survive.
You could have gone all day without saying that.
It's true, and you know it. Hollis says he beat her almost methodically and violently raped her at least 3 times. She was so damaged internally, she'll never be able to have children. Add to that the sheer physical and emotional shock of being blinded, and the odds are that neither a pregnant woman nor her child could survive the attack.
Andy shook his head, his face grim, but said, "Did you get anything helpful from the interview with Hollis?"
"I don't know. Maybe. Details, but not the sort to help the police. At least not yet."
"Such as?" Maggie drew a breath and let it out slowly, trying not to sound as tired as she felt.
"He used spearmint-flavored gum, or breath mints. He hummed to himself sometimes, but not a tune Hollis recognized. He was fascinated by the texture of her skin and her scent."
John moved slightly in his chair, and under his breath muttered, "Son of a bitch." Maggie sent him a quick glance of apology. It had to be hell for him, hearing this sort of thing and knowing that his sister had also been held and tortured by the same animal. In situations like this one, an informed imagination could be a lot worse than an ignorant one. For the first time, Maggie realized that he probably slept no better than she did, and that his nightmares undoubtedly grew more vivid with each brutal fact he learned about what his sister had actually gone through. Andy, more adept than either of them and not letting his emotions sidetrack him, said to Maggie, "Those don't even sound like the sorts of details that might help you. Are they? Are you beginning to see this guy?"
"Every detail helps me see him. Eventually."
Every detail? Every throb of agony and anguish she had felt right along with Hollis, and Ellen, and Christina. "Do you have a sketch yet?"
"No, not yet."
John said, "Andy, I know your boss would hate it, but is there any way we can see the Mitchell house today?" "We? Maggie and me."
Maggie wanted to protest, but bit back the words. She had so far managed to hide from Andy her reaction to actual scenes of violence or suffering, and intended to keep it that way if she had any choice. It was difficult enough to do what she did without having to also cope with the increased uneasiness or even fear she knew most of these cops would feel if they saw one of her little performances. She had no idea what John thought of what he had witnessed on Saturday, but she didn't doubt he and his friend had discussed her. His supposedly psychic friend. She felt cold and worried. Was she moving too fast? Could she afford not to?
It was so desperately important that they stop this monster before he destroyed more lives. But what would be the price demanded if she chose the wrong path? And who would have to pay it?
"Maggie, are you up to it?"
Andy asked. She nodded.
"I'm fine."
A lie, but she thought it was probably a pretty convincing one.
"I know Maggie usually walks the scene eventually,"
Andy said slowly.
"But why you, John?"
"Because he wants to watch me."
But Maggie didn't say that, of course. She just waited silently.
"I suppose," John said, "because I'm trying to immerse myself in the investigation, to see everything. And who knows, Andy? I may see something all you cops miss. I may not be trained in police work, but I usually don't miss many of the details when I turn my mind to something."
It was the truth, Maggie thought, but not all of it. Andy drummed his fingers on his desk for a moment, eyeing John intently, then shrugged.
"I'll okay it. I wanted Maggie to walk it anyway, and you might as well go along, although I doubt you'll find anything we missed. The forensics team should be just about finished up by the time you get to the house, and Mitchell has given us permission to do whatever it takes to find his wife, so I don't imagine he'll object, if he even notices, which is doubtful."
Maggie got to her feet when John did, but paused to ask Andy, "Is there anything else? Anything new?" Only someone who knew him well would have seen the hesitation before he replied, "No, nothing. At least until we have the forensics report later today." Maggie pretended she didn't know him well, and nodded as she turned away. She'd have to come back here later and corner Andy, try to find out what was going on. Unless it was her, and not John Garrett, he didn't want to tell. She didn't much like this. If it came down to it, where would her loyalties have to lie? With the police, or with John? That shouldn't have been a question, but it was. And she knew why it was. Pushing those troubling thoughts aside for the moment, Maggie followed John from the station. He didn't speak until they were on the steps, and then it was to make a wry request.
"Would you mind if we went together in my car?"